the Volunteers. Heath Shuler is not used to losing.
No, in high school, he was 40-5, leading his team to 3 consecutive state titles. But this guy's a competitive guy. He's never really lost 2 games in a row, but he'll come off the mat hard. He'll be whipping it around, and when he hands it off, it'll be to Charles Gardner, who's done a wonderful job running the football for Tennessee.
And his defense, led by Todd Kelly, will really be rushing a young quarterback here. And that young quarterback, not your typical Western Pennsylvania, hard-looking, tough-looking high school football player, Steve Tannehill.
Steve Tannehill, this effervescent pigskin slinger from Altoona, Pennsylvania, has assured himself a spot on the SEC all-fashion team with his hairdo and his earrings. But, you know, his confident and enthusiastic approach to the game is just what the Gamecocks needed. They were disillusioned and disheartened at 0-5, and he's brought them back.
But all that means nothing without the results. The last 2 weeks, he's gotten the results. Their rushing average is up. Their passing's gone up about 30 yards a game. Their scoring has really just about doubled the last 2 times out. And the Gamecocks are making some noise in this Eastern Division again.
Yeah, we saw them against Kentucky. They ran the ball well, and Tannehill's added the passing dimension to their offense.
Last week, he had 11 completions. Those went to 7 different receivers. And we'll talk a little bit about cabooses when we return. Welcome back to Columbia, South Carolina. Gamecocks are 2-5. The Volunteers are 5-2, going in different directions right now, but sort of at the end of the train going in one direction is our man Bob Kessling outside the stadium.
Best place to party in South Carolina before the game is in the Cockaboose Railroad, which is just outside Williams-Brice Stadium. 22 railroad cars have been painted up, decorated, and this is where South Carolina and today Tennessee fans are partying, getting ready for the game. In fact, these cars have been totally redecorated inside. Each one is a little bit different. This one, of course, in honor of Halloween with the Gamecock pumpkin. The Tennessee fans, South Carolina fans are back here. Ed Robinson is the guy. This is really your idea, Ed. Are you the guy that came up with the 22 cars and got them here?
That's right.
But it's really been caught on. It's really popular.
Oh, it's really popular. I mean, you know, especially with, you know, times like this, you can see our Tennessee folks in here, our friends from there, and our South Carolina people. We're having a hell of a time.
I gotta say, now, will you make it in time for kickoff?
Oh, yeah, we'll be in just a second.
Well, good luck. Who's going to win the game? What? The Gamecocks? All right. You guys enjoy the game. Have fun. We got to get the kickoff. Tennessee and South Carolina. Have fun, guys.
Well, I saw the TV in there, but Kessling's duty will be on the sideline today. He has been kicked out of the Cockaboose, and we're ready to kick off here in Columbia, South Carolina. Back with the opening kick after a pause from your local stations. Welcome back to Columbia, South Carolina. Just a few seconds ago, the Gamecocks, to the screams of 2001, took the field. And I'm telling you, Tim Foley, if that doesn't send a shiver down your spine, you're masquerading on Halloween as someone who's not living and breathing. It was something.
That ranks right up there with the Florida State rascal riding out onto the field with the spear and throwing it into the ground. Great way to start.
And the bottom line is they are excited again about football here in Columbia. Tennessee will kick the football. The Gamecocks lost their first 5 games. They're playing again for the second consecutive year, the toughest schedule in the nation. They've won their last 2, 21-17 at Vandy last week after a stunning 21-6 upset of Mississippi State. The season record, the series record, of course, is led by Tennessee. Volunteers have not been here in 2 decades to play, but they picked a great day to come back on this Halloween. Mid-70s, wind not a factor, very comfortable, and any chance of rain has now been erased from the forecast today. Tennessee, meanwhile, winning its first 5, and then, of course, losing in the upset to Arkansas and then being handled by Alabama 2 weeks ago. Tennessee usually comes dressed on Halloween as a pretty good football team. They've won 10 of 12. The Gamecocks, a .500 team on October 31st. A lot of Tennessee supporters are here. Johnny Majors putting up with some of the sting of those 2 defeats. He's been hearing a lot of negative calls around the Knoxville area the last 2 weeks, but there are a lot of folks here to cheer their team on to a possible win here today.
Johnny's been in coaching for 25 years. He's used to that. He knows that fans can be fickle, but they've got a great program rolling for them at Tennessee, and they've got an awfully young football team, and expectations might have been overbuilt by their early success.
Junior kicker Joey Chapman, the kickoff man for the Volunteers. Frank Adams, who leads them at 21 yards of return, is back there with Brandon Bennett. Volunteers in their orange pants, their Rhodes white jerseys. Gamecocks in their home black shirts and their home red helmets.
Last time we saw Tennessee play was against Arkansas, and the special teams played a critical part in that football game, as Arkansas dominated the game in terms of field position.
They're waiting a bit to clear up the band out of a portion of the end zone. Now they've got the ball back on the tee. Tennessee has to win here today. 3-2 record in the SEC, with Georgia and Florida dueling in Jacksonville. Chapman's kick hangs high in the air, about 6 yards deep for Frank Adams. No way. And the Gamecocks will have it at their own 20-yard line, first and 10, led by the true freshman quarterback out of Altoona, Pennsylvania. Steve Tannehill goes 6'5", 200. In the last two ball games, he's 18 for 31 with three touchdown passes.
Here we go.
And he's really breathed some life into this offense.
They come out of the eye. Four-man front for the Volunteers. And the second man through breaks a tackle. That is Brandon Bennett. And he's got good yardage on first down out to the 29-yard line. Tannehill with Bennett and Rob DeBoer, one of their all-time best backs here. Stacy Robinson gets a start at wide receiver, as does Don Chaney, who goes 6'6". And then Boomer Foster is the tight end. Up front, the offensive line, Vince Dinkins is a sophomore. Otherwise, they're all seniors, Dye, Farrell, Rivens, and Rosenkranz. On second down, Brandon Bennett has first down yardage out around the 34-yard line. Tennessee, of course, made the famous switch from the 50 to the 4-3 defense. Todd Kelly, the ringleader up there, with good help on the left side, James Wilson. Tullis and Surlis, the tackles in the middle. George Kidd, a redshirt freshman, plays the inside with Reggie Ingram, and the outside backer is Ben Talley. They are a veteran crew in the secondary, except for Jason Parker. He's a true freshman out of Garland, Texas. And a draw play, carrying him, Rob DeBoer. He's out over the 35. Good yardage for DeBoer, who comes in averaging 53 yards a game. He had 89 against Vanderbilt last week.
And the longest run in history for him from scrimmage, 39 yards. DeBoer out of Omaha, Nebraska. And he's a punishing runner, and he's the type of kid that is a great example for everyone. And he displays the attitude that everybody in this Gamecock team needs to have. They're going to resurrect this thing this season.
And four, it'll be second down and 6. Tannehill in trouble, and he will have to eat the football. Good pressure by the Volunteers, and then it turned into a coverage sack. James Wilson got him as Tannehill looked down the field, could find no one open, and he had to just go down to the turf. And that's something that some freshman quarterbacks will have a problem with against such a defense like Tennessee's.
With Kelly on one side and Wilson on the other side, those guys have combined for 15 sacks this year. They really get a lot of upfield pressure on those tackles.
First tough yardage situation for South Carolina on 3rd and 10. Tannehill will air it out. Far sideline, he hangs it up, and the ball is knocked down. Toby Cates, the intended receiver, and that freshman we talked about, Jason Parker, number 7, defending.
Let's watch Parker and McCluskey here. McCluskey, number 6, Parker, number 7, backpedaling in a 2-deep zone. Parker, as you mentioned, was rated one of the top high school talents in the country last year by many different services, and he's come up with a couple of interceptions this year right on the ball.
Marty Simpson had a great punting day against Vanderbilt last week. 8 kicks for 47 yards. Kind of a wobbly spiral. Sean Summers at his 29. Good coverage by the Gamecocks on a kick that hung up almost for 4 seconds. Jerry Inman, a defensive back on special teams with the stop. Ball changes hands. We're 2.5 minutes in. No score. We'll watch the Volunteers and Heath Shuler go to work when we come back. Volunteers of Tennessee will have the football for the first time as Heath Shuler brings them out. 6'3 sophomore out of Bryson City, North Carolina. He's completing 56% of his passes, third best in the league. And he looks for Charlie Garner, and on the first play, he might go. He gets inside the 25-yard line. Norman Green from pre-safety on the stop as Charlie Garner goes way over 500 for the season with that run. A 44-yard play from scrimmage.
They've got Hayden and they've got Stewart, but Garner really is a north-south runner, really attacks the hole. Watch this. Watch it open up on the right side. Good job by Bubba Miller sealing it. Now you see Jeff Smith, number 7. Well, that's 44, Brunson getting the block, and now it's just Garner's off to the races.
On the next play, it's Garner again. Look at just a couple off the right side. Tennessee came in averaging 204 yards on the ground per game. They got about 1/5 of that total on their very first play. Garner with Brunson in the backfield. Robert Todd, the tight end, does a lot of blocking. We'll see a lot of David Horn. Greg Faulkner, the wingback. And Corey Fleming. Stowell is the star up front. His 20th straight game started at left tackle. On second down and 8, Garner slips. He was cutting upfield. Was thinking about that first down and maybe more when suddenly he lost his footing at the 20-yard line.
He was going a long way on that one. He had a blocker out in front and everybody on the ground. And so Tennessee coming out trying to establish the run. You know, they had their most difficult time they've had in a long time moving the ball against a really stiff Alabama defense. They traditionally average 400 yards a game, and Alabama cranked them back to 194.
Tennessee 41% on third down this year. They need 5 yards. Straight ahead. Ball should have been caught, but it was not. It was Robert Todd, the tight end, who has not caught a pass this year. Check it. That's David Horn. Horn comes in catching situations. Todd is more of a blocker. Turnipseed, Bembry, and Sullivan up front for the Gamecocks. They play four linebackers with Dixon and Franklin on the outside. Brown and Campbell inside. Watkins and Green are sophomores at the safety positions. Rocky Clay, the only senior back there. And on for a field goal of 37 yards is John Bexford, who's 9 for 10 this year. Near that right upright, and he missed it off to the right side.
That's the first time all year, Bob, they've been inside the 20 that they haven't scored. The very first time.
The old orange zone, they've been calling it in Tennessee. And now they're 24 out of 25 inside the 20 scoring this year. They pass up a golden opportunity, and 4 minutes in, it stays scoreless. Carolina takes over at its own 20-yard line. They show a strong side with Boomer Foster on the left, the tight end, and he promptly jumps. And Todd Kelly says, okay, I'll come across the line of scrimmage. There's Kelly. 21 and a half career sacks. When you're playing tight end or any position against this guy, you want to get an early start.
Oops. The idea there is if the offense moves, the defense can accelerate. Todd Kelly accelerated on Boomer Foster, and he is something else. Out of Hampton, Virginia, he's got 10 and a half sacks this year, and one of the only people that had previous experience in terms of major playing time on this Tennessee defense.
Now they put the tight end wide to the right on first and 15. And the give is to the deep man, Brandon Bennett. Bennett, a 6'4 sophomore out of Taylor, South Carolina. He leads the Gamecocks with 86 carries now, averaging about 4 yards per tote. He's gone for 350-plus yards now.
Turnout on Kelly. They start it headed upfield. Good job by Farrell and Dinkins and Rivens up the middle, giving Bennett some room.
And nothing much happening on that play as they went off left tackle with Bennett again. On second down and 9.
We've
got a great matchup to watch today. Ernest Dye, who has got the chance to be a number one draft choice, against Todd Kelly, also another probable number one-er. So they're seeing a little bit this afternoon what it's going to look like for them every day next year.
Third down play, third down and seven. Carolina's been under 30% on third down all year, and Tannehill under deep pressure, and he is sacked back inside the 20-yard line. He did not see pressure like this by Mississippi State and Vanderbilt like he will today.
Well, Larry Marmee got a new little wrinkle. They put Todd Kelly on the other side away from Ernest Dye, and he heads upfield, confuses the blocking assignments of the Gamecocks, and Kelly gets another sack.
And a kick for Marty Simpson again. Sean Summers back at his 40. Volunteers who drop back for the return will have good field position, borrowing a mistake. He's got it at the 47, crosses midfield, and he's got about 5 yards on the return. So on the near hash, the Volunteers will have great field position on their second possession of the day. Their first, Johnny Major's first play from scrimmage in 2 weeks, started out in dramatic fashion with a Charlie Garner 44-yard run. They could not get another first down and missed what should have been a makeable field goal.
Johnny's always teaching, as is Sparky Woods. Three-time Southern Conference Coach of the Year with Sparky.
Pitch, possible reverse, and here comes a man around the left side, Ronald Davis. He will get inside the 40, down to the 39. Charlie Garner pitching it to Davis, who backs up Craig Faulkner at the wingback position. And a flag on the play, lying at the 45-yard line.
Time they get it to Ron Davis, and Ronald can really run. He's got a lot of speed. He's only caught three passes so far, but they've got a clipping on the play. So the ball is going to be taken back here.
That'll cost the Volunteers big yardage back at the nose of the football, the 40-yard line. Johnny Majors had come up with big plays each time on his first plays. And in his 16 years at Tennessee, he's only lost back-to-back games five times, including the last two. It'll be a first and 22 for the Vols. Garner the motion man. And they go out that way again, Ronald Davis. Good coverage by the free safety, Norman Green.
Davis, a sophomore with a lot of speed, has the ability to really bust a big play. He comes back. They do a good job of keeping Bubba Miller from getting out there. You see Bubba's getting out there, number 71. He's a little late. The lineman grabbed him a little bit and kept those linemen from getting out there into that quick screen.
Davis was an honorable mention All-American at Bartlett, Tennessee. That was his fourth catch of the year. Three wide receivers for the Volunteers as Shooter drops back and goes straight ahead and over the 45-yard line for Corey Fleming.
That young man took a whipping the last time he was out. Alabama really came after him, and but he's coming back strong, as Johnny Majors pointed out. Very, very competitive young man, as Corey Fleming pulls that ball in. Nice catch, leaves it. Third and six situation for the Tennessee Volunteers.
Ball is almost at the Gamecock 43-yard line. They need to cross the 38 to move the chains. Shuler looking out to the right side all the way for the wingback Faulkner. Nothing doing. Tony Watkins from strong safety wrapping him up. Not a good pattern, because the ball was caught about 3 or 4 yards short of the marker, and then Watkins playing tight made a rather easy stop.
Faulkner running his route here, does an excellent job of getting open, catching the ball. He's not supposed to take it upfield. He's supposed to take it laterally so he can be a release when South Carolina blitzes, which they did. But a great job by Watkins. Not trying to kill him, just grab him and put him on the ground.
Darrell Harris and Stacy Robinson waiting for the kick from Tom Hutton. The left-hander hangs one up high. It will hit at the sticks and squirt into the end zone. Hutton averaging 40 yards a kick with a long of 52 against Florida. That one for 40 yards and exactly 8 minutes in. Still scoreless in Columbia. A happy Halloween to you. No scoring yet in Columbia, South Carolina. Volunteers and Gamecocks are scoreless. Bob Carpenter, Tim Foley, Bob Kessling on the sidelines again with us today. And Tennessee playing very well on the road over the last three or four seasons.
Well, they've played pretty well regardless of where they are. As you mentioned, Majors has only lost two games in a row five times since his time at Tennessee. The last time was Florida and Alabama last year.
Steve Tannehill leading the Gamecocks, their third possession. He will pump, throw it up top down the sidelines. And the crowd feels like his receiver, Asim Penny, was held up a little bit as he made his turn upfield. That's a tough play for a defensive back to snuff out. You expect the quick sideline pass, then the pump, and the receiver turning upfield.
Well, Sessions played it well. He was in good position. He wasn't over anxious on the pump, and he jammed Asim Penny, and you can do that in college. The ball wasn't in the air, and that elicited a boo from the crowd, but that's how it goes.
Tannehill 0 for 2, second down and 10. And a tough catch out there on the right side. Stacy Robinson, who's splitting time at wide receiver with Toby Cates. That's his ninth catch of the year.
Now he puts the heat on this one. You're going to see a volunteer in hot pursuit as he tries to zip this in along the sideline. Not a lot of room. George Kidd is right there. Great throw by Tannehill.
Casey Robinson didn't play last year. Broke his leg in the spring. He was a quarterback in the 89 and 90 seasons. Third down and 5. Tannehill with time. Out to the left side, but the ball is dropped by Robinson. It was thrown a little bit low. Receiver backpedaling, facing the quarterback.
They feel like they've got it in the flat here. Stacy Smith turning, he's not looking back inside. George Kidd man-to-man on Stacy Robinson underneath. They feel like they can get it out in the flat. That time Tannehill threw it a little bit behind him as George Kidd closed.
John Summers waiting for the kick of Marty Simpson. Summers at his own 36-yard line. Volunteers should come out with good field position again. But this one is a beauty. Back to the 27. Summers hit there. Now he escapes. We have a flag. He's loose at midfield and down to the 45-yard line or so of South Carolina. But there is a flag at the 29 of Tennessee. A 49-yard kick. That ball hung up in the air for a full 5 seconds.
When a ball hangs that long and the first guy misses, you may have a problem. Tennessee experienced that against Arkansas at the close of their game a couple of weeks ago.
Two big clipping penalties, one of them from scrimmage and now one on the punt return.
Got a missed tackle there and then another missed tackle and people just run by it. Now Summers has got a good chance to pick up some yardage, but they called a clip earlier in the return.
We have an illegal block in the back against the receiving team during the return. First down.
Ball down to the 19-yard line, and let's go down to Bob Kessling.
Guys, this is a very big game for Sparky Woods. Naturally, they need to win. But it's also a big game because he's from Oneida, Tennessee. In fact, he played at Carson Newman, which is just outside Knoxville. In fact, he was on the Tennessee staff, a graduate assistant in 1976 when Majors came from Pittsburgh to take over the team. They've had a relationship all those years. Woods would like to beat the Volunteers today, though.
Play action by Shuler. Incomplete out to the left side. Mose Phillips with the ball glancing off his hand. By the way, more connections between the Gamecocks and the Volunteers. David Bybee, the assistant head coach, a Tennessee player that played on two bowl teams, and Tommy West, who's the co-defensive coordinator for Sparky Woods. He was a tight end at Tennessee and a teammate of Bybee's back in the mid-70s, and he played, wore the orange for three different bowl games. Second down and 10 at the 19, a busted play, flags all over the place. A
know, Tennessee started out the season with reeled off five victories, a fantastic game against Georgia. Very exciting.
Dead ball foul. False start on the offense.
And when we saw them a couple of weeks ago against Arkansas, they were very confident, rated fourth in the nation. Well, now they've had two losses in a row. They let the Arkansas game slip away from them, and 2 weeks ago they were in a battle with Alabama that really anybody could have won. And so they're anxious to win again. They're anxious to perform well.
This time they fake the reverse, and keeping the ball out over the 15-yard line and out toward the 20 is Charlie Garner. Right end Eric Sullivan of South Carolina handling things at the line of scrimmage against big Mike Stoll.
And Sullivan was the defensive player in the year last year in South Carolina in high school as an inside linebacker, had 155 tackles. They moved him to a down lineman position because they needed some help up front, and he has just responded in excellent fashion.
Sullivan out of Lawrence, South Carolina. Just a freshman. Bobby Ivey coached the state champs there a year ago. Out to the right side. Grabbing it there is Ronald Davis. Gamecocks know they have to close on him quickly. And they are fired up over on that sideline. Lockie Clay, Tony Watkins, right corner and strong safety in on the stop.
A little twist on defense for South Carolina. Usually Rocky Clay is back into the sideline. He's the boundary corner. But because Tennessee does so much with their split end back into the sideline, they've got Frank Adams back to the inside. And Watkins and Rocky Clay corral Ronald Davis and don't let him escape that tackle and prevent him from getting a first down.
Tom Hutton, left footer. He really booms one. This one sends Terrell Harris back inside the 25. He wants no part of it. And then the roll will take it all the way down to the 10. Maybe even the 9-yard line. A huge kick by Tom Hutton. His previous high this year was 52 against Florida. That a 65-yard kick and roll.
Hammer, he launched that one, didn't he? Terrell Harris dropping back. I mean, that ball was over the fence. He wasn't going to get to it, and the best thing for him to do in that position is just get away from it. He made a good decision. But Hutton has backed them up and put him on a 9-yard line.
Raggedy Ann taking in the action here on Halloween. First down at the 9 for the Gamecocks. Their fourth possession. They run a draw play, and getting outside in good fashion is Terry Wilburn. Wilburn, who backs up Rob DeBoer. He's averaging about 5 yards a carry. That is 58th carry of the year, just a sophomore. He's out of Spartanburg.
Out of Spartanburg, he was a high school quarterback and a 100-meter dash champ in high school, and he can really fly. Had a great game against Kentucky when we saw him. Puts a little juke there on J.J., but J.J. stays with him, McCleskey, and drags him down. Wilburn at four, great tandem.
Yeah. Gain of 9, and here comes a bunch more for Wilburn. He gets outside to about the 33-yard line. So on two pretty basic running plays, the Gamecocks get out of trouble from their own 9 out to the 32. All 23 of those yards in the two plays from Terry Wilburn.
Let's watch him work up front. You see number 48, J.J. Surlis, Todd Kelly, 58. Linebacker fills. Wilburn eludes the tackle and heads upfield.
Tannehill running into his running back. And improvising is Wilburn and getting away. Not the cleanest exchange you'll ever see. And Terry Wilburn said, okay, now I'll see what I can do with it. He did plenty.
Sparky may put this one in. It worked so well. As you alluded to, they've got a little problem here. Up to the right, to the left, and they slip around some folks. Robinson blocking downfield as Wilburn picks up about 11.
He has 3 runs for 34 yards on this drive. And now over midfield, dancing inside. Brandon Bennett, he is still loose. Inside the And we're under the overhang here on the near sideline. This is one of those stadiums where on a play like that, you can feel the place moving.
Really, I'm getting vertigo up here. Great job running by Bennett. I mean, you got to have a better effort than that from Tracy Smith and from everybody on the Tennessee defense right now. I mean, they have to turn it loose a little more. You know, they're catching people right now, and they need to start hitting and attacking like they know how to do.
On a first down play from the 24, it's Bennett again, just a couple this time.
What do we want?
You know, your frame of mind is so important and so fundamental. You know, if you expect to lose, you're going to lose. Tannehill comes in there. Okay, now I got the job. We're going to win six in a row. And, you know, and people were saying, well, this is a little cocky, isn't it? Well, what they needed was some leadership. What they needed was some forcefulness, and he's provided it. They haven't thrown the ball in this drive, you've noticed. They've run it very well.
They didn't even throw when they had second and one. Now it's second and eight. There's the pump up top, way overthrown. He was looking out there for Toby Cates, who never did get the corner turned to speed down the sideline.
Good job by Sessions. He didn't bite on it at all. He didn't go for the quick hitch, and he just waited back there for Cates. They bring Bennett and DeBoer out. Good pressure on Tannehill there. But he responds well to it. He's used to that.
South Carolina, nothing on third down so far today. And they will call a timeout with 2 minutes and 30 seconds to go in the first quarter of play. No score here in South Carolina. The Gamecocks are coming off the wins over Mississippi State and the win at Vanderbilt, Tennessee, a week off after the losses at home to Arkansas and Alabama. Let's get an update from downstairs. Here's Bob Kessler.
One thing to look for in the Tennessee defense right now, Kevin Mays, number 96 from Kingston, Tennessee. He has been out. He got hurt in spring practice. In fact, had a knee operation. He has been out all year. He came back a little bit in the Alabama game. Didn't play any snaps, though, but he dressed out. Today is really his first action of the season. Tennessee really hadn't gotten that much against the run the last week, stopping them. They're hoping today Kevin Mays can step in there and stop the run. But so far, Carolina, on this drive at least, has been pretty impressive. Also, a thing to watch, Ben Talley's been a little bit shaken up, the linebacker. They had Scott Gallion, another freshman, in there just a minute ago. That would mean George Kidd and Scott Gallion, two freshmen, are playing linebacker right now, a very important position for Tennessee.
Well, they knew they had a problem at the beginning of the season in terms of experience when they graduated nine starters. Larry Marmee and Ray Hamilton, Tim Keene, and John Chavis have done a great job at educating these younger players, but they really have no experience depth.
Three wide receivers on third down and eight. Tannehill with a straight drop up the middle, man open, touchdown! That is Mike Reddick. They snuck the redshirt freshman in there, and he scores his first touchdown of the year. Carolina goes on top of Tennessee.
Great read by the freshman. Great call by Sparky Woods' staff. Reddick comes wide open up the middle.
Ronnie Simpson, 6 of 7 on conversions. He just did keep it inside the right upright. He's 7 of 8, and it's 7-0 South Carolina.
Tannehill's been working the outside, working the outside. Somebody was supposed to check that back coming out of the backfield. You check if he's blocking, you blitz and engage. If he's not blocking, then you have to cover him. Somebody made a mental error here, and Reddick comes wide open in the middle of the field and gets it into the end zone.
And South Carolina continues to score touchdowns. Unable to put the ball in the end zone at all early. Only averaging 9 points a game their first 5 games, and then averaging 3 touchdowns for each of the last 2. Tannehill had their seventh touchdown in their last three ball games.
After Tannehill threw that pass, Reddick got into the end zone. He dropped down to one knee, said a little prayer, and then he did a dance at half field. He waited for the receiver to do it, and he's just an exuberant, enthusiastic young man that's breathed some life into all these Gamecocks.
Marty Simpson on the kick. Ball is into the end zone, and Ronald Davis will run it out straight ahead. And that's a good decision for the Volunteers. They get out to the 27, maybe the 28-yard line.
And what a coach always looks for is, you know, you look for talent in an individual, and you look for a team player if a guy is going to be a leader, but you look for someone that can take charge, someone that's got some confidence, and that can spread that confidence to other people when things aren't going well. And Sparky, that's what Sparky Woods has found in Steve Tannehill. Seven plays, and they did it on the ground with the exception of the last play.
And running straight ahead, Charlie Garner for Tennessee. Boy, their first down plays today have really been something. Tony Watkins from strong safety on the stop.
Tannehill talking to the quarterback coach, the offensive coordinator, Art Wilkins upstairs. He's trying to get a report on what defenses Tennessee's playing and what their tendencies are. Are they sticking with the tendencies that they had coming into the football game?
Coming out, it looked like the official was ready to reach for one, and then he did not.
No draw. He went to his pocket. He went to his pocket, but then he figured, I guess, that the ball was out of reach.
Ronald
nice throw
Davis,
by Shuler.
Rocky Clay covering Ronald Davis.
Well, that's a little bit of the mismatch, and Carolina knows that. They felt it was not catchable, incidental contact. Unless you have an orange hat on, and you think it's definitely flagrant pass interference.
Third down and one. And just pushing it ahead, Heath Shuler on the quarterback keeper. Looks like he got the yardage. Johnny Major's probably feeling on their first couple of possessions today, Tim, that the only team that could stop Tennessee was Tennessee because of those penalties. Three early penalties for 30 yards. Really robbed his team of some great field position.
Right, and he is now in the ear of the official that did not throw that flag.
Jim Foley's alma mater, big over the Wolverine. There's a late pitch from Shuler. Garner getting outside. And he'll be out of bounds at about the 44-yard line. You will not be able to sing that song in its entirety until that score is a final.
Okay, let's watch Ronnie Smith here. Moving down the sidelines. He's from Athens, Georgia. He's a true freshman. And, great lateral pursuit down the line of scrimmage. Another one of the true freshmen. They're making their mark in the SEC.
Second and six. Shuler looking straight ahead. Four-man coverage by the Gamecocks on Corey Fleming. As Shuler was under some pressure as well.
Great job. You watch 53, Keith Franklin. He drops, gets a great drop. Shuler can't throw it. He interrupts the route. And now Frank Adams, who's their best man-to-man player, is right there to break that pass up. That Tennessee's fortunate that Frank didn't make that grab. Perfect position.
Three wide receivers on third down and six. Shuler out to the right side. Well short. Kendrick Jones, the split end, was angling in. Rocky Clay on the coverage.
Good disguise by the Gamecocks. Tony Watkins was in a position where he looked as if he was going to blitz from his strong safety position. He faked the blitz, came back out. Shuler had to go to his second receiver and was a little bit off, low to the inside.
Darrell Harris, back at his 15 for Tom Hutton's kick. Picked off a 65-yarder last time. This time he pushes it up high in the air. Fair catch at the 11. So with 49 seconds to go in the first quarter of play, Carolina on top, 7-0, and they'll have the football after a 45-yard kick.
Last time they were in this position, Bob, they drove the Hummer 90 yards for a touchdown. They came out of there running the football, and let's see if they can continue to do that. I'm sure that the Tennessee staff has been hard at work analyzing what they're doing to them on the ground.
Tannehill went one way, looked the other way, and that's at least their second or third busted play back there. Terry Wilburn, Georgia Tech, with Duke hanging tough in Atlanta today. Second quarter ACC action.
Don Chaney coming into the ball game at wide receiver, and there does seem to be some confusion, and you can expect that when you've got a true freshman playing quarterback there who is changing plays at the line of scrimmage. That'll happen every once in a while. The last time they had some confusion, Wilburn ran for 13 yards.
Second down and 11. And the give going nowhere as Tennessee was all over that one. Todd Kelly on the drop. And that should be the final play of the first quarter. So after 15 minutes of play, it's South Carolina with a Reddick touchdown catch, leading Tennessee 7-0. And we'll be back with the second quarter from Columbia in just a moment.
It is a gorgeous day in the Southeast for football at Williams-Brice Stadium. Is at the end of the first quarter, it is South Carolina leading Tennessee 7-0. There's a game within the game here. They are shooting a movie. It's called The Program. So we've got Eastern State University. They're playing Michigan. They're going to film it at halftime. They filmed some of it before the game. These are the Timberwolf cheerleaders down here.
On third and long, South Carolina decides not to shoot themselves in the foot, not to take a gamble. They keep the ball on the ground. Very wise decision. They don't want to give Tennessee any benefit here. Now they're going to be punting it from their own end zone. They're playing good defense right now, and that was a wise decision. And some people say that's a conservative call. Exactly. You get yourself in trouble by making non-conservative calls when you're on your own 10-yard line.
And again, a chance for Tennessee to have good field position. Summers fumbles it at the 48, recovered by South Carolina. It is number 21, Frank Adams, the cornerback on special teams.
Right now, Johnny Majors is looking for the full moon. You know, they can't get anything to go their way. Summers takes his eye off the football, bounces off his shoulder pads, and Frank Adams, Mr. Everything, is there to fall on the ball. Up into the air, nice move.
First play, Tannehill gives it off. Bennett hurtling his way. Still fighting down inside the 35.
Success is contagious. You see Brandon Bennett attack that hole. You know, like he couldn't wait to get there. You know, when they're 0-5, I'm not sure that they were running with quite that much enthusiasm or quite that much positive expectation that anything would be there when they got there.
And you could hear the crowd go, ooh, as Brandon Bennett was met head on there. That tough 4-3 of Tennessee. Shane Bonham from left tackle, who backs up Jeff Cullis on the left side with a good hit.
Shane's a transfer from the Air Force Academy. He's got 5 sacks this year. He's playing pretty tough. Bennett's feet fall out from under him as Bonham and Farrell, the center, were going at it. Good job by Shane stuffing that interior.
Loss of 1 in the play. Second down and 11. Tannehill changing the play at the line of scrimmage and now calling timeout. Last time he called timeout, they scored on the next play. So don't go away. Who knows what might happen when we come back. 7-0 Gamecocks. Beautiful pictures here in Columbia today, and you're getting them from the Family Channel Airship. Terry Dillard is at the controls today on a beautiful South Carolina afternoon. Second quarter, 13-17 to go. Carolina with the lead and driving. Second down and 11. And it's across the middle. Ball was a little bit low and behind Toby Cates. But they are finding some big openings in the middle of that field, Tim Foley.
Yes, they are. That time, Tennessee trying to put on a pressure Kelly there. And that ball just nosed over a little bit on Tannehill. Took a dive on him. Cates couldn't get to it.
Only 2 of 7 so far in his previous two starts. He was 18 for 31. But he had not faced a defense like this.
No, he hadn't. And the other thing is that his ability to pass at least loosens up Tennessee a little bit, so they can't just sit there and squat on the run.
On third and 11. Out to the left side. Ball is caught. But Asim Penny way short of first down yardage by a good 4 yards.
Well, this play seemed to be changed at the line of scrimmage, and he runs a hitch, and the ball is thrown low and behind him. Might have even been ruled incomplete as it started to slide out, but Asim pulls it in, and now it's fourth down. They got a field goal attempt coming up by Marty Simpson.
It would be a 44-yarder. Simpson 2 for 2 in the 40 to 49 range. Derek Gregory snaps it. Derwin Jeffcoat is the holder. They're on the far hatch. And it's a low line drive that is wide to the right side. Either team can put one through the uprights at that end of the field. Not sure what we call that costume on Halloween afternoon. I guess it's just a couple of rabid UT fans on the road here in Columbia today.
There sure are a few of them here as you look around. And as loyal a group of fans as there is in the country. And you find that pretty much at all these SEC schools. They'd have to call off the fall. You know, if you couldn't play football, they'd want God to move this thing from September to January.
And he'd probably do it. On the first carry, Charlie Garner tripped up, unable to get outside. Good emotion right there. Chris Rupp, 58, who backs up Keith Franklin at that outside linebacker spot. There's David Turnip seated left end.
See David Horn in there, that right side of Gordon and Smith trying to create something, but good hustle by the Gamecock defense. Shuts it off for Garner.
4 wide receivers for the Volunteers. Keeler looks right. Nothing there. He'll run it to the short side, and he'll have to get out of bounds with Cedric Bembry, 6 foot 285, in pursuit. Shuler's stats coming into the game were 66 for 118, so he's not exactly having a big day either.
They had a major rebuilding job doing this offense, though. Phil Fulmer and Majors have done a great job. They had to replace McCray and Davis, Galbert. Oh, no, that's the wrong list. Adams, Reeves, Andy Kelly, Carl Perkins. Picking just a bevy of great players.
There's one down the middle on a third down play. It is Corey Fleming all the way down to the 30 of South Carolina. They flooded the secondary with 4 receivers, and they found a big seam up the middle.
Some of these receivers are starting to get enough experience now that they're developing into the kind of receivers that Tennessee is used to having. Mose Phillips curls it in over the middle. They were playing a 2-deep robber style defense. Safety just wasn't there. Frank Adams saves a touchdown.
Corey Fleming with a 41-yard play, his longest catch of the year. 3 wide receivers and a wing back this time with a single back set. And Shuler on the quarterback draw will find his way down near first down yardage. They need the nose of the football to the 20, and he got about 9 of it on that play.
And this is a great job. In these situations, a lot of defenses like to go man underneath, and this is a quarterback draw. This isn't a scramble. This was a design play.
Shuler ran for 2,500 yards in high school, passed for 7,600. Now they go option right. He's got the first down.
Once they get inside the 20, Bob, they like him carrying the football. He scored 8 touchdowns this year, and it's on that option. They low block the tight end. I mean, they low block the defensive end, and he Shuler keeps the ball. And as you pointed out, he is a fine runner, a great athlete. I jumped 6'9 in high school, so I mean, he's got all the skills and leadership ability.
Played center on the basketball team, hit 390 as a baseball catcher. That time he pitched it, and Charlie Garner found not much on that left side. This is the 26th time this year Tennessee's been inside the orange zone. For the first time this year, they did not score in this game when they missed a field goal. Of the previous 24 times, they had 19 touchdowns and 5 field goals.
That is really remarkable.
I guess we should change that to were. Now 24 for 25. Shuler dropping back, almost tripping, under pressure, unloads it, just off the hands in the end zone. Ball was almost picked off by Rocky Clay. Tony Watkins from strong safety pressuring on the blitz.
Defensive staff here at South Carolina has 2 defensive coordinators, Tommy West and Miles Aldridge, and this time they decide to come after him. You see Franklin coming from the outside. They're coming from the other side also. Watkins can't pull him down. He gets the ball away. Rocky Clay is there to make the catch. Would have been a great catch. Would have been a tremendous catch for a defensive back. But Rocky wasn't able to hang on.
Tennessee calls timeout. 9:33 to go in the first half. Tennessee trying to come back and tie it up. Tennessee coming out of its timeout, approaching the football.
5 defensive backs in the game for South Carolina.
Now South Carolina has called a timeout. I guess Sparky's not planning on a 2-minute offense. That is it for his timeouts in the first half. We're going to Starkville next Saturday. Looking forward to seeing the folks over there in Bulldog Country as Mississippi State hosts the Razorbacks of Arkansas. 12:30 Eastern, 11:30 Central Time. And the announcers who will be there are selected and compensated by Jefferson Pilot Sports. We hope it's us. This broadcast is a copyrighted presentation. Any use of this broadcast without the express permission of the Southeastern Conference and Jefferson Pilot Sports is prohibited. We don't get a chance to go to Starkville very often, and we are looking forward to seeing the great folks over there.
These are my old college roommates here. Where'd you design that hairdo? Who you got there? Can I borrow that?
Sure, anytime you want, you got it.
Who are your friends here?
This is the Wandering Jew and
this is the only, what do you think about these guys?
It's Halloween!
I've been thinking about the same thing. I gotta keep my roommates under wraps, though.
Put them out in the caboose or a boxcar or something. Now, out of the 2 timeouts, 3rd and 8 for the Volunteers. Shuler rolls right, looking to throw. Clear out, and he is cracked out of bounds. Hank Campbell from inside linebacker, number 85.
Good penetration there by Campbell, who was a walk-on last year, actually. Had some academic problems, left for a while in the spring, got his grades up, and now he's back. And I'm not sure that was ever going to be a pass downfield. The receivers looked like they were lining up to block. Keith Shuler probably was instructed to get rid of the ball in a hurry to one of the receivers in the flat or just take it and go.
John Bexford near that right goalpost, and they do stay perfect in the orange zone. We'll tell you about our little correction of our statistic when we come back. With 9:22 to go, second quarter, Tennessee's on the board, but South Carolina still has the lead. Volunteers have their first points of the game. 7-3 Carolina leads it with 9:22 to go. In the second quarter of play, as John Bexford is hit from 31 yards. He's 1 for 2 today, 10 for 12 on the year, capping a 60-yard drive that took just over 3 minutes. Now, we were told that the last time they went down, it was not inside the 20, Tim. It was at the 20 and a half. So they didn't actually make it into the orange zone until this last possession. So now they're 25 out of 25. Our crack stat crew spotted the foot and a half difference from what we were spotting the ball there. So Tennessee stays perfect in the orange zone this year, 19 touchdowns and 6 field goals. The Family Channel Airship is providing us with great aerial photography today. The ship measures 132 feet in length and can accommodate 4 passengers. On a gorgeous day overhead, Richie Noe, a running back for Tennessee, playing on special teams, is the man injured on the play.
There's a lot of traffic up there. That Family Channel blimp is dodging those Cessna 152s, dragging around all these signs.
Yeah, most of them are political messages, radio station type things, win this, win that. Bob Kessling has an update on probably the most versatile guy on the field today, J.J. McCluskey. Bob?
You know, today is a very big day for J.J. McCluskey, but also the election next week is very important. This past summer, J.J. worked as an intern in Tennessee Senator Jim Sasser's office. He has hopes to one day be in politics. I asked him, do you want to be a senator or a congressman? He said, no, I don't want to do the national stuff. My goal one day is to be the mayor of Knoxville. And the way he's playing right now, he's got a good shot at it in a couple years.
Well, his coach calls him the tempo setter for this team, so he obviously has great leadership qualities. There's No being taken off. Richie No, a senior running back out of Lake City, Tennessee. We'll check on his condition and let you know how he's doing. First down for the Gamecocks at the 20. Tannehill quickly out to the left side, stepping around his man, Toby Cates, and turning a quick pass into good yardage for a first down.
Great job by Cates there. He's a converted cornerback, as you pointed out. They needed his athletic ability on offense, they felt, and you see why. Good throw by Tannehill. Again, the ball, the nose of the ball seems to kind of come over the top and dive a little bit. It makes it a little bit tougher to catch.
Well, when he leaves, Stacy Robinson comes in. But they go with a running play. Not much doing there, maybe even the loss, as Terry Wilburn was the carrier. Good look there at Steve White, a redshirt freshman who's the third man behind Todd Kelly and Horace Morris at right end. Don't see much of White. And another player down, that's George Kidd, the left linebacker.
George Kidd's a converted running back in the spring because of the all the people they lost on defense. They moved George Kidd over to outside linebacker, and he's just a great athlete, a good kid. Talking to Larry Marmee about him, he just said that George doesn't miss anything. You know, he's very coachable and a real student of the game from Milan, Tennessee.
Well, John Tucker, the head coach there, appreciated his efforts. He ran for almost 1,000 yards, only played 8 games his senior year. Redshirted last year, ran for 3,300 yards when Johnny Majors brought him to Tennessee.
And Johnny Majors brought some other people to Tennessee from Milan. Ernest Fields was from there, John Fisher was from there, just to mention a couple.
What about it, Tim? A couple of weeks ago, this guy was about the most popular man in the state. Now they've been all over him since the loss to Arkansas and Alabama. Very rare for the Volunteers to lose 2 at home in a row.
Well, we heard Hope George Kidd's all right. Now, you know, people that create, there's only a couple of people. You can create an uproar with a couple of people. There's call-in radio, talk shows, and it only takes a couple of people to write a few letters, to throw a few things, and it makes it sound like everybody's against them. Of course, the Tennessee fans are frustrated, but they also know that this is a young football team.
Second down and 11. Most of them know. Out to the right side, a seam penny. A flag flies.
And they're going to call pass interference, I think, on the offense, I believe, because there was a block being thrown while the ball was in the air.
Tennessee pointing as if it is going to go their way. It is on the offense. Sparky says, say what?
See if we can show it to you here. The slot man, Tannehill's throwing it to the outside. The slot right there, the slot man is blocking a defensive back, and that's what they call his pass interference. You can't do that. You can do that if the ball's thrown behind the line of scrimmage.
15 yards from the previous spot and a loss of down.
So that is a huge one. Michigan has come up with a touchdown. Speaking of Michigan, a rather odd occurrence is taking place at the stadium today. A team that looked like Michigan was out here before the game playing a team that looked like Florida State. Now we're told Georgia Tech will be coming on the field at halftime. They're filming a movie here about college football called The Program. And using the big crowd here, they had a mock-up of a couple of touchdowns before the game. It was interesting to see the Wolverines playing the so-called Fighting Timberwolves of Eastern State University. Coming to a theater near you sometime in the near future, and you'll see some scenes from the stadium here. That scene, not a good one, is on third and long. Tannehill could not get it done, and the Gamecocks, with 8:07 to go in the first half, will have to kick the football.
They want to try to keep Tannehill out of those must-pass situations, and they've been very effective running the ball this afternoon. You don't want to place the whole burden on this young man's shoulder.
Marty Simpson will kick it to Sean Summers. And again, Tennessee should come out with good field position. Summers at his 39. We'll see if Simpson can beat him out of it. Oh, there's a beauty. Back to the 27. And they'll get about seven of it back on the return. But Marty Simpson, who had a great week at Vanderbilt last week, is really stroking the ball well. That a 55-yarder, and he didn't need any bounces to reach that kind of yardage.
Well, when you're trying to get things back, you're trying to get things going, that certainly does help, because field position can really be critical in this game here.
Tennessee will turn it around at their own 34. Plenty of time for a long drive here. They go to James Stewart. They're calling Little Man. He's the third tailback. They've got Charlie Garner, of course, who has the breakaway speed. Aaron Hayden, who's most consistent. They look to him down deep, as they do to Stewart, who has a knack for punching the ball into the end zone.
Well, last year was pretty much Hayden and Stewart. But Charlie Garner has come in out of Scottsdale Community College and really has taken over at the tailback position, although they still alternate.
On second and three, it's Little Man again, trying to tumble ahead to first down yardage. He needed the 45. Hank Campbell on the stop. Not too often you see an offensive football team who has three guys playing the same position, basically, and they're 1-2-3 on the team in rushing.
Yeah, Tennessee has had some great tailbacks over the years and some great wide receivers. And Phil Fulmer has really created some great linemen, too. Charles McCray and Antoine Davis, they graduated last year. Harry Dahlbrust down there playing with the Dolphins. Bud Wilkerson, Bruce Wilkerson, Eric Still, John Fisher, Tom Myslinski. They've just done a wonderful job of turning out pro linemen here at this program.
E. Shuler for the first down. This is an important drive for Tennessee. They have not stuck the ball into the end zone today. They did score in the most recent possession, a John Bexford 31-yard field goal. They got the clock with them. They can wear down South Carolina here a little bit in the second quarter if they can drive it down and take the lead. This could be a real tone setter for the rest of this game. Shuler out to the left side, man open. That's Craig Faulkner, the wingback. And he's down to Carolina's 28-yard line. Faulkner with his 20th catch of the year.
He was the second man through. They'd run off the corner. Faulkner lines up in the slot, heads out toward the sideline, then bends it upfield. Mose Phillips is in the short zone. And Keith Shuler didn't really get a tight spiral on that one, but it's good enough for the completion and a long gain for the Tennessee Volunteers.
Inside the 30 of South Carolina. Shuler changing the play now. And a give to the fullback. First man through, that's Mose Phillips, the sophomore out of Nashville. Former Tennessee Player of the Year. He was an option quarterback and a DB at Hillsborough High School. There is a flag on the play.
A good receiver from Tennessee, too. Catches the ball well coming out of the backfield. As you can see, they've got South Carolina offsides. You know, defensively for Sparky Woods, Gamecocks, they expect a lot of performance out of Cedric Bembry, who's out of Miami, Coral City High School.
Offside.
Preseason All-American.
And
they've got some help up front from Eric Sullivan. That defense is playing well, and the offense is starting to come back to life. Sparky was a three-time conference coach of the year in the Southern Conference, and had a very successful program at Appalachian State. They brought him in here in 1989 to conduct the affairs of South Carolina football program. In 89, he's 6-4-1. And then he ran into some situations that he couldn't really control and got off to a really rocky start this year. And the Wolves started howling, but the team voted that, you know, the coach should change. And Sparky told them that they didn't necessarily have a vote. Whoever wanted to play, come out to practice tomorrow. And that was really the beginning of the turnaround.
On first and five, getting outside is Stewart, and he is inside the five before going out of bounds.
Little man Stewart, we heard little from him until this last drive. And he has done most of the work for the Volunteers. They're in striking position at the South Carolina 3-yard line, even about the 2.5.
Jane Stewart does a fine job of staying with it to the backside. Stoll stayed with his man to create that hole. Hank Campbell finally hustles over there to drive him out of bounds after Adams missed.
First and goal. They pitch to Stewart. He is outside, cuts it up, and he's knocked down by Tony Watkins.
Now you give Charlie Garner a pitch like that, he'll say, okay, I'll race you to the marker out there. Stewart, not quite as quick was Stewart, and he tried to cut it upfield.
And he is their scoring guy. I mean, he scored 4 touchdowns, and South Carolina really hustling to get to the football, and Tony Watkins makes an extremely sure tackle here. Great job by Watkins, turns it upfield and nails him.
Second and goal from the 2. The pitch goes Phillips, and he is into the end zone. Great fake in the backfield by Heath Shuler. And then the simple pitch, and Mose Phillips has his second touchdown of the year.
Fine job of ball handling here by Heath Shuler. He keeps it till the last possible moment before he lets it go. And you're going to see Watkins in the same position he was in on the last run. Dumps it out to Mose. Campbell coming over the top. Watkins hustling to the corner. He was concerned about that, and Phillips got it on the cutback.
John Bexford for the point after perfect. And Tennessee has done what we thought they might. They've taken it right down the field and score. They didn't use much block, only a couple of minutes. Still 5:21 to go before halftime as the Volunteers now take a 10-7 lead over the Gamecocks. A 7-play, 65-yard drive that took only 2.5 minutes.
You watch Campbell come over the top on this replay. This is, you know, they're attacking, they're upfield. Here they come, 85. He's going to take it on over the top. Shuler pitches the ball to the outside, and it really is tough for Watkins because Phillips had the angle on him to the corner. He really could have gone either way, and a little dance and dip-de-doo, and David Horn getting a headlock, say come on back to the bench.
Things are looking up now for the folks in orange who are all over that end of the stadium in the end zone and up in the corner, lower deck and upper deck. Several thousand Tennessee fans here today. Of course, maybe those are some of the folks who can't get tickets in Knoxville. They'll go down to Columbia and take over a couple of sections with all that orange. Volunteers on top now. Brandon Bennett back for the kickoff inside his 5. Joey Chapman puts it to the 5-yard line. And Bennett is hit hard. That is a big hit on special teams by Victor Brown, a junior defensive back. We heard that one up here.
Vic Brown was a strong safety. They moved him to outside linebacker to help bolster that core, and they may need him today with George Kidd being assisted off the field earlier in the game. Good hit by Brown.
former junior college All-American. And now it becomes very important for South Carolina to do something. They've got all those Tennessee folks right behind them as they start at their 20-yard line. Tannehill, right side. Out to Asim Penny. Looks good for first down yardage out to the 33-yard line. Penny's out of Maryland, Bishop McNamara High School in Clinton, Maryland, a 6'5 sophomore. He's got a good-looking future. That's a tandem that could be completing passes around here for a long time. Toby Cates is just a sophomore. Brandon Bennett is only a second-year player, as is Terry Wilburn. The two running backs, Bennett and Wilburn. Tight end moves up to the line. That's Boomer Foster. They run off that right side, and getting loose is Rob DeBoer. And he's out of bounds over the 40-yard line. Flag on the play, back at the 36.
Well, in the first quarter, it was the Tennessee offense that kept shooting itself in the foot. In the second quarter, it's been the South Carolina offense that's had problems with penalties. This time they get Tennessee defense for being offside. Old John Major's been at it for 25 years. Twice offside. National Coach of the Year.
Decline, second down.
He's been the Coach of the Year in every conference he's been in. Started out there in Iowa State.
Former single-wing tailback at Tennessee back in the 50s. Johnny's 57 years old, and 1957, the year that he graduated in Knoxville. Second down and one. Again, they shift the tight end. Single back with DeBoer behind Tannehill. Play slow and developing, and Tannehill improvises and hit Toby Cates. But a flag on the play. Everything at the line of scrimmage looked like it was in slow motion that time.
I think they got Tennessee again. Kenny Farrell snapped the ball, and Steve Tannehill, figuring he has a free play, tried to work himself free and fire it downfield. Assumed the penalty was on the Tennessee defense.
Offsides, defense, first down.
Well, let's see if Bob Kesslin can stay where he's supposed to be down there, Bob. All right, we'll check in with Bob when we get an opportunity. Now it's first and 10 at the 48.
I knew he liked that caboose.
Tannehill waiting and waiting. Finally, he's got his man. Boomer Foster, the tight end. There's another flag. Boomer Foster, flag down.
Boomer Foster was one of five true freshmen last year.
What is going on here?
You're going to see Larry Marmee.
Defense. Decline.
You see the defensive coordinator, Larry Marmee, who's genuinely a general, usually a calm man. He's going to jump out of the press box here in a minute, I think. They must be changing the cadence of the snap count. They must be fiddling with the ball, doing something to get Tennessee to jump like that, as Johnny mentions it to Kim Keene on the sideline.
On a first down play, nothing much for Brandon Bennett off the right side. Purdue has come up with another score. They lead the Wolverines at halftime, 17-7. Michigan, number three in the nation. You know, that could be great news for Alabama. Number four, they don't play today, and they could move up a spot if Michigan gets upset by those Boilers.
And even if Purdue doesn't hold on, and they're not notably strong, they're on the rebound, they're on the rebuild, but it may affect the positioning in the polls.
Yeah, that could be one of those weak losses that the pollsters look at. Here's Bennett looking strong inside the 30. Steve Session from left corner to stop him. But Brandon Bennett having a big day. 10 rushes, 75 yards. And he's over 1,100 now for his career with a big afternoon.
Dives up, make it look like a pass to get Kelly upfield, and looks like Jesse Sanders overran it. They've got Jesse Sanders playing for George Kidd back at the outside linebacker on the left side.
There's
first and 10 at the 28. Tannehill changing the play. Quick look to the right, nothing there. In trouble, and he's sacked back at the 35-yard line. Steve White, the right end.
And that's a freshman mistake right there. He's throwing a hitch. It isn't there. Throw it away. Throw it over his head. You try to make a play, try to go to your second guy, then get rid of it on the sideline. Find somebody around the sidelines and throw it. But Tannehill stayed with it too long and took the sack.
Loss of seven. On second and 17, Tannehill. And a good lead and a nice grab by Toby Cates.
This is a hitch because they covered it so tightly the last time. Now Tennessee's rolling there. Sessions is in a zone. Cates is the one now that starts moving on his own, takes it inside, finds a soft spot, and Tannehill stuck with him and put it on him.
Third down and six with 2:05 to go in the half. Tannehill looking left side, now up the middle. He's got the tight end inside the 5-yard line, Boomer Foster. Foster with only 5 catches all year. In fact, he only had 3 going into the Vanderbilt game. Tannehill found him twice last week and twice again here.
He's been working the sidelines, and now they come out, a 2-deep zone. Nobody jams the tight end, and he's free down the middle.
New quarterback for South Carolina, number 10, the redshirt freshman, Blake Williamson. He handles things down in the what they call the attack zone. Williamson giving it out, over the top, into the end zone. From the attack zone to the end zone, Blake Williamson to Brandon Bennett, and South Carolina re-grabs the lead.
Blake Williamson, who scored the winning touchdown last week against Vandy, hands it to Bennett. There's no stopping him. This rascal's in the air. Send him to Kate Kennedy.
Extra point struck through by Marty Simpson. And South Carolina answers the Tennessee touchdown with a rather quick one of its own. With a minute 28 to go before halftime, Carolina 14, Tennessee 10. We've got a good one on our hands here in Columbia on Halloween.
USC! Williamson, who handles their short yardage and goal line offense, hands it to Bennett. Jason Parker comes up there and gives him a good crack, but Bennett's already over the top. Watch number 7 come up. Ingram fills it. Jason Parker comes up, but by then they're in the end zone. Tally back in the football game. DeBoer leading the way. Good blocking there, and just Brandon Bennett launched himself over the top. Says hello to some fans. Things have been tough here in Mudville, but we're back.
His fourth touchdown of the year. They have some good young players. Talk about youngsters. Tannehill, the freshman, to Foster, the sophomore, to set it up. And then Bennett, the sophomore, into the end zone and a 4-point lead just before halftime.
And Cates played a big part in that drive. Sparky Woods has got some real talent here, some young talent, and they're starting to gain the confidence that's necessary to compete and win in the SEC.
Wicked bounce off the face mask of Ronald Davis. Now he tries to get outside. Gets to the 20, feeling his way along the sideline, and they'll mark him out around the 25. Say one thing, Tim. These teams have shown quick strike capabilities today. The scoring drives in this game, 2 minutes and 19 seconds by South Carolina, 3:03 by Tennessee, 2:33 by Tennessee, and 3:53 by South Carolina. The ball is moving right up and down the field.
Exactly, and you saw John Majors take the headset from John Chavis, the linebacker coach, and he's talking upstairs to see what's going on.
First down for the Volunteers. David Horn, the motion man. And then across the line of scrimmage was Ernest Dixon with Mike Stoll in front of him.
Now we saw that earlier in the game. That was an Ernest Dixon payback there. Todd Kelly had done that earlier in the game to Boomer Foster.
You know, Tim, a couple of weeks ago when we talked to Johnny Majors, he was looking forward to the week off after playing Arkansas and Alabama. But with that week off, this team, their timing totally off right now. The penalties are just killing them today. And they're very simple penalties. First and 15. Play action. Craig Faulkner over the 40. His second big long catch of the afternoon. Now the Vols will run up the field. Tennessee still has two timeouts remaining.
Sometimes you start getting too technical as a football player and you lose your enthusiasm and your recklessness. And I'll guarantee you see a different team at halftime.
Shuler cuts it off for the tight end, David Horn. He's dumped out of bounds. Volunteers will stop the clock with 1:01 to go in the half. Tight ends becoming a force in this game, especially Boomer Foster of South Carolina.
Tennessee, last year their tight ends, Reeves and Adams, caught 45 balls. Coming into this game, their tight ends had caught 3.
Second down and 5. Shuler dropping to his own 40. Has to dump it and gets it off. And it is caught by Garner. Still up on his feet at the Carolina 40-yard line. Great poise by Heath Shuler. He was really under pressure, and he'll call a timeout. Jamal Pettiford, coming in from left end, was thinking sack.
Looks like they're trying to get it to Craig Faulkner as he crossed the field behind Hank Campbell. You can see Faulkner getting down the middle. It's not there. Shuler makes the decision to hit just a little circle back, and boom. This guy's hard to knock off his feet. I mean, that's about as much smash as you can put on somebody, and Charlie Garner stays up.
All 5'10", 185 of him. Shuler now, 9 for 15 passing for 135 yards after a slow start.
Shuler talking to John Majors there, Randy Sanders, the receiver coach, and on the phones upstairs, David Cutcliffe and Phil Fulmer. They've worked together for, Fulmer's been with Tennessee for 13 years. I think David's been here 9 years, or been with Tennessee for 9 years. And that's the kind of consistency that a program needs to be successful. In South Carolina, they've changed coaches quite a bit. They've had 29 coaches here in 90 plus years, and that's a bunch.
First down, Tennessee, at the South Carolina 39 with 49 seconds to go in the half. Gamecocks lead it 14-10. Shuler lets him come and dumps off the screen pass. Garner broke one tackle. It would have been a great tackle by Tony Watkins, but he did slow him enough. And valuable time will tick away here. Tennessee has one timeout left.
Good block by Bubba Miller out there in front. It always amazes me when these 290-pound, 300-pound guys get out in front of the back.
Second and 5. Out to the left side, and that should have been caught. Corey Fleming was thinking about what to do with the ball before he had control. The incompletion will make it a 3rd and 5 with 22 seconds left.
Breaking it to the outside. Shuler delivers it on time, on target. And as you mentioned, Corey starting to think about going upfield before he actually put the ball away.
Tim, that drop could be the difference between being in field goal range and not for the Volunteers if they don't convert here on third down. Shuler with time. Little pattern out to the right side and trying to dive it ahead for the first down was the tight end, David Horn. I think if they mark it, well, where will they mark it? Clock is stopped with 10 seconds to go. He did not get out of bounds.
They run Horn out in the flat, Bob, and they're curling the split end in behind him. Horn makes the catch. Adams is there. Drags him down. The ball pops out. And they don't have it.
It'll be fourth. Maybe half the length of the ball. They are in field goal range of John Bexford. He's hit one from better than 50 yards this year, a 53-yarder against Arkansas. But no kicking team is on the field right now. Looks like they're going to run a play, try to get the first down, maybe call a timeout. Clock is running down. Now they call the timeout with 4 seconds to go, and the kicking team will come on.
John doesn't want to leave any time on the clock. The way he looks at it, after I get my 3 points, I'm going to go in and talk to these rascals.
Hopefully down by a point from the Tennessee standpoint. John Bexford, this would be about a 46-yard attempt. He's hit from 31 and missed from 37. 37 was first. The made field goal was the second one.
He's got the leg for it. He's been a great performer for him this year. It's into the wind a little bit, which may affect him.
Well, Bexford, out of Chattanooga, wanted to go to Florida State. He sent them a videotape of his action when he was in high school. Got a nice letter back and found that the Seminoles never opened the envelope to look at his videotape. He's a good-looking sophomore kicker who was 9 for 10 coming into this game.
They weren't all shorties either. I mean, he's nailed some long ones.
Hit a 44-yarder against Alabama a week after the 53-yarder against Arkansas. This will be from 47 and a half. Right hash mark. Plenty of distance. Did he pull it? It is wide left. And that's how the first half comes to an end. Johnny Major's kicker missed two in the first half, and he's down by four.
Bexford puts a little heat on it, tries to get a little extra distance, and it ends up pulling wide to the left.
All the body English couldn't help that one, but here's Bob Kessling with Sparky Woods.
Coach, your team played hard in the first half.
Played hard. We had some mistakes that took us away the first quarter of field position. Boy, Tennessee did a great job. Their punter backed us up one time, took field position away. They gave us an opportunity where they dropped a punt. We didn't get any points from it where we missed our field goal. But we held up in some places, and then our quarterback made a couple of plays to give us a chance to get back in it. So we've got a sure, strong 30 minutes ahead of us.
Running the ball against Tennessee, that's an advantage for you, isn't it?
Well, our backs are running hard, and we're playing pretty good on the line of scrimmage. And we've had some things where backs have broke some tackles. We're fortunate early they missed some tackles, but right now, we're mixed in a pretty good run fast, but Tennessee, you can't count those guys out. They'll be ready this half, I know.
Big second half. Good luck, Coach.
Thank you very much.
Sparky Woods, the head coach of the Gamecocks. His team is at halftime leading the Tennessee Volunteers by a score of 14-10. We'll continue from Columbia, South Carolina after in just a moment. In William Bryce Stadium as the South Carolina Gamecocks hosting the Tennessee Volunteers this Saturday. Let's look back to last week and some of the key games in the conference, and we start with those South Carolina Gamecocks. They were on the road last week in Nashville, gunning for their second straight win of the season. After falling behind 14-0 to Vanderbilt, Carolina's defense dug in, led by linebacker Ernest Dixon. The defense held until freshman quarterback sensation Steve Tannehill got the offense in track. Here he hits Don Chaney on a 55-yard touchdown strike. The score helped Carolina cut the Vandy lead to 14-7. big plays in the game defensively. This one turned in by Carolina. Frank Adams stops the punt attempt. That set up another Gamecock touchdown. Brandon Bennett took it in for the score, and Carolina cut the Vanderbilt lead to 17-14. Then Blake Williamson, subbing for Tannehill, scores on this end run, capping the comeback. As South Carolina beats Vanderbilt, and for the second straight week, Sparky Woods is smiling. In the standings now, Georgia on top of the SEC East by a game over Tennessee and Florida. And over in the West, Alabama still undefeated, leading Mississippi State now by two games in the loss column. And we'll be back at halftime here in South Carolina after this word from the University of Tennessee, the University of South Carolina, and a word from your local station.
Super Bowl Sunday, Kelly drops back to pass. Ball gets intercepted, Brad Edwards.
That Super Bowl interception was one of the highlights of my career. Hi, I'm Brad Edwards of the Washington Redskins, and I'm proud to be a graduate of the University of South Carolina, where I received a well-rounded education that emphasized ethics and values. From our College of Humanities and Social Sciences, the medical and law schools, and the nation's number one international business program, the University of South Carolina is a proven winner.
Bob Kessling, thank you very much. Bob Carpenter, Tim Foley upstairs. Tim, I think something you said early in the game makes all the difference right now for South Carolina. Confidence. This is not the same team we saw about 5 weeks ago.
No, it wasn't. It's being led by a guy that believes that they can win, and that has become contagious, and so they're giving Tennessee all they can handle right now.
Let's have a look at some of the scoring today. In fact, it was South Carolina playing ever so confidently, getting on the scoreboard first today, as it was Steve Tannehill on a 22-yard pass to Mike Riddick. We hadn't seen anything from Riddick in the game until he went right up the middle for this one.
And it was just, it looked like a missed assignment here. Nobody's close to Riddick. A two-deep zone, and he goes in unmolested.
That's how the first quarter ended, 7-0. John Bexford of Tennessee, with 9:22 to go before halftime, made it 7-3 with a 31-yarder. And then it was Tennessee going ahead on a Mose Phillips 2-yard run. They took the ball down the field, 2.5 minutes, 65 yards for this drive.
And Tony Watkins had stuffed Shuler on the play before. This time, Mose Phillips gives him a move and gets into the end zone.
And not a bad move after either.
Yeah.
Maybe they should have kept the ball longer, because then South Carolina went 80 yards in 3:53. Brandon Bennett went in from 2 yards to make it 14-10.
Three offside penalties on the Tennessee defense and a couple fine throws by Tannehill combined with a good rushing effort by South Carolina.
Let's have a look now at our Ford halftime statistics. South Carolina with the edge in first downs. Tennessee in rushing, passing, and total offense. Time of possession belongs to the home team. One turnover by Tennessee. Shuler is 11 of 18, 144 yards. Tannehill, 8 for 14, 103, and a touchdown. Cox by 4 at the half. Another shot from the family channel blip overhead here at Williams-Brice Stadium, Columbia, South Carolina today, where 71,529 are watching a dandy football game. The Gamecocks lead at the half by a count of 14-10. Tennessee will receive the kick. Marty Simpson knocks it down, and it's Ronald Harris just outside his own goal line. Straight ahead, running hard. Ronald Davis out to almost the 30-yard line. Cedric Surratt on the stop for the Gamecocks of South Carolina. If we've learned one thing in this league the last 4 weeks, Tim Foley, it's that there are no easy games. We've seen Arkansas upset Tennessee. We've seen Vanderbilt give Georgia at home all it wanted. We saw Ole Miss give Alabama at home all it wanted last week. And now the Gamecocks, something brewing here today. Keith Shuler. And running hard is his tailback. That is Charlie Garner.
That's good old fashioned Tennessee football, straight ahead. You know, right behind Spivey and Miller and Smith. Stoll. Well, Stoll was a guard last year, Mike Stoll, and they moved him out to tackle because they had lost Bernard Daphne and Patrick Lenore. He's done a great job out there.
Garner with 5 yards on first down, sets up a passing situation, and Shuler going long down the right sideline and nothing doing. Corey Fleming, the intended receiver. Norman Green, the free safety, with him step for step. Shuler now 11 of 19.
Try to get it over the top. Norman Green there on defense from Sumter, South Carolina. Good pattern, good call, trying to strike, trying to make something happen in a hurry. Third and five, they feel like they can convert that. Second down, they're willing to take a chance.
Three wide receivers, draw play, and they do not make it. Garner was knocked down just beyond the line of scrimmage by Eric Sullivan, the right defensive end.
Eric Sullivan did an exceptional job coming off his pass rush to knife under Garner. Sullivan getting turned upfield, and he plants and comes back into the play. Great play by Eric Sullivan. Eric Brown there to help out. Tennessee has to punt.
Tom Hutton will kick it to Terrell Harris. Left footer just got it away, a wobbly kick. Harris has to come forward. Now he can't make the play. And it'll bounce down inside the 10-yard line, even to the 5. Harris did not come forward quickly enough to field the ball on the fly. Then he made the right decision by not trying to catch it. But, Tim, I think he should have come forward and caught that ball.
No question about it. You know, when you're a coach, I personally wouldn't care if the guy catching the ball could run a foot, just as long as he could catch it, secure it, and you get the ball.
A 60-yard punt. About 20 of it came on the roll. And the Gamecocks, with the nose of the football at their own 5-yard line, led by a freshman quarterback, could not make a mistake down here. Robinson, the motion man, and a straight give to Rob DeBoer. He's Mr. Dependable down there, and he'll get 5 or 6 yards on first down.
He's a fine athlete, plays baseball. He's a catcher and a designated hitter. And, of course, as you pointed out, his 89 yards versus Vandy last week was the high of his career. I don't see George Kidd on the field for Tennessee.
Corey DeLucci has replaced Kevin Rosenkranz at right tackle for the Gamecocks. Second down and 3. DeBoer again running into an orange wall. There were some black shirts in there, too, because the Volunteers stood the Gamecocks straight up, and there was no hole to run through. 58, Todd Kelly in the midst of it. 48, J.J. Surlis, who's playing with arthritic knees. He's quite a story. His dad, Tom, was an all-SEC linebacker, Bama in 71, and his career ended because of bad knees. Surlis just playing through the pain. Doctors say he'll hurt if he plays or he doesn't, so he says, hey, why not?
Football solution.
That's right. Third down and 2. 3 men in the backfield. Pritchett was the motion man. And getting out to the 20-yard line for a first down is Brandon Bennett.
That time we saw a new look from South Carolina. You're going to see number 12, Toby Cates, playing quarterback here. Reggie Ingram moving along the line of scrimmage, makes the hit. Brandon Bennett runs right through him. J.J. McCleskey hangs on to make the stop, but just excellent running by the sophomore from Taylor's. 85 yards, down for 100.
Yep, he's averaging about 7 yards a carry today. 3.5 minutes into the second half. No problem on that exchange. Thus, not much running room for Bennett as Shane Bonham got in from left tackle. There's Bonham, the guy from Alaska, via the Air Force Academy.
He started out the fall as an end, but because of some help they needed inside, they slid him down inside. He had a great game in the Arkansas game that we saw, and fought against Auburn valiantly. George Kidd, we've learned, had the sprained knee, and he's not going to be back this afternoon.
Second down and 10. Tannehill taking a draw, blindsided and taken down. Number 90, Ben Talley, the right linebacker, came all the way around, and Tannehill never saw it. Talley, with his first sack of the year. He had 56 tackles from the outside, including 14 against Alabama, but a sack for the first time this year.
Tannehill does a nice job of hanging on to the football without ever sensing Talley's coming. Talley tried to strip the ball from his arm, and Tannehill hung on.
And here's where Tannehill has to hang on to his poise, Tim. Third and 17. They'll keep it simple with a draw play to DeBoer running up hard up over the 25-yard line, but he needed to get to the 30 for the first down, and the Gamecocks will kick it away.
Another good call by Sparky Woods. You don't want to put the freshman in the situation where he feels like he has to make a play backed up. Young quarterbacks have a tendency then to force the ball. You watch number 16, Victor Brown, until a couple of weeks ago, he was a strong safety, but because of injuries this afternoon to George Kidd, he's called into action here as an outside linebacker.
Marty Simpson having another good day kicking. Sean Summers, the return man of the Tennessee 30. This one not so good. Wobbles. Now here's a guy who comes forward to catch it. That was a good aggressive play by Sean Summers. The kind of play that Carolina did not get from Terrell Harris. Volunteers in good position, but they trail by four. At 11:30 Central on our SEC network station. And right back here in Columbia on first down, good yardage for Charlie Garner. By the way, Arkansas is playing at Auburn this afternoon, and Mississippi State is on the road tonight at Kentucky. Florida and Georgia play at 3:30 today, and LSU is at Ole Miss this evening. Alabama, top dog in the West, not playing.
Charlie Garner, a tough runner. You know, when they get near the sidelines like that, you'd like to see those folks that do such a great job holding those yard markers. Let them go.
Garner stopped behind the line. At least he was slowed by Delvin Herring, a redshirt freshman who backs up Cedric Bembry at nose guard. There's big number 93, who goes 6'5", 270. He's out of Jacksonville.
Herring recovered a fumble last week against Vanderbilt at the end of a game that kind of sealed South Carolina's victory. Great penetration, and good close on the tackle.
Vanderbilt, the other SEC team, not playing today. Big play here, third down and four. In the third quarter now, with Purdue still leading Michigan by 10. Shuler with time, straight ahead, first down and more inside the 30-yard line. Again, it was Corey Fleming as Shuler rifled one right to him.
Look, we had five wide receivers in the game that time for Tennessee. Shuler throws it back into the short side, dumps it to Fleming. Tony Watkins trying to rip the ball off, but Fleming hangs on.
Fleming, three catches, 84 yards. First down at the 28. Garner on the give. Running hard, slanting off the left side, and he'll have good yardage on first down.
Tennessee's always, well, since I've been watching anyway for the last 10 or 11 years, had a great running attack, good line movement up front, well-coached people up front. Always had a good explosion off the ball, and they always had somebody like Charlie Garner back there to give it to love to run.
Second down and four. Shuler, easy pass out to the right side, and that is Ronald Davis. Davis only caught three passes coming into the game today, but he's been active.
Little run fake here. Shuler comes out to the outside and breaks containment. Nobody there. There's two Gamecocks back there guarding a wide receiver in the slot. Faulkner, and he dumps it to Davis in a flat.
His third catch of the day out of Shuler's 13 completions. 20 yards for Ronald Davis. They'll run the option left side. Shuler keeping it to the end zone and scores. Heath Shuler runs the option beautifully. And Tennessee takes the lead by two with 7:02 to go, third quarter.
a lot of quarterbacks that are Shuler's size aren't as agile as he is. Watch this. Norman Green tries to play through him to the ball. He doesn't have any help on the outside. He figures he can get Shuler to pitch it and then just play right through it to the ball. But Shuler does a little arm over, ducks him, and goes in for six.
John Bexford right down the middle with the point after. And it's 17-14 Tennessee. 7:02 to go. We'll be back after a pause for a word from your local station. Pete Shuler leading the way, finishing the drive, and Tennessee leads 17-14, 7:02 third quarter. Brandon Bennett back to receive the kick. On the goal line, looked at the official, then he decided to run it out. And he gets out to the 22, maybe the 23-yard line as we watch Shuler option beautifully from 15 yards out.
Beautifully executed play. Everybody handling their assignment. Watch number 71, Bubba Miller. Bubba, he blocks Chris Rump to the inside. Good job, Bubba. Here comes Mario Brunson. He's going to cut down Tony Watkins. That's what you call loading the man that's responsible for the quarterback. Norman Green trying to run through the quarterback, but there was a pitch man outside of Shuler. If Green would have committed to Shuler, he just would have pitched the ball and somebody else would have gone in for the score.
Let's get more on Heath Shuler. Here's Bob Kessling.
Yeah, you talk about Shuler. Last week, Tennessee was open. He had a chance to go back to Bryson City, his hometown, where they retired his number. He also got a chance to watch his brother play, Benji, who is a senior wide receiver and is being highly touted as a recruit, not only in the SEC, but in the ACC as well. So who knows, next year maybe it might be to Shuler here at Tennessee.
Well, today he's well over his average of total yards. He has 171 passing and 36 rushing.
Done a fine job. A tremendous amount of composure for a young man his age, and just everything that you're looking for in a quarterback.
Heath to Benji. Sounds good for Tennessee fans. But Benji Shuler, if he comes to Knoxville, have to beat out some pretty good guys just to get in there. Gamecocks at their 23. Tannehill swinging it out right side. Toby Cates juking and getting out for a gain of about 9 yards or so on first down.
Tannehill never looks like he's under any pressure at all. I don't know if it's the sun in his eyes, but he's got that smile on his face, not really concerned. Got a little bit upset with one of his throws that was low and in the dirt, and kind of pounded his hand on his helmet. But a man that's very confident under the center with the ball in his hand.
What will they do on second and one? They were conservative first time they had that today. They'll keep it simple here. Get the first down and out across midfield. Great run by Brandon Bennett. That'll get him up around 100 yards for the day.
Watch these young linebackers at Tennessee work here. Number 90, Ben Talley attacking. They get blocked, and then Brandon Bennett has the ball, and he is running with true desire.
First down as he's well over 100. Little misdirection in the backfield. DeVore blocking for him, and he gets down to the 46 of Tennessee. 5:50 to go, third quarter. Still anybody's ball game. Sparky Woods trailing by 3. I think he's pretty happy with the position his team is in right now. They have played Tennessee straight up for better than 2.5 quarters of this football game.
And as they move the ball, Bob, it's not trick plays. I mean, it's straight ahead running.
Second down and 8. Tannehill, blind side coming, and he gets rid of it as Kelly was all over him. Brandon Bennett, the intended receiver. I think Tannehill was just happy to find somebody out there to dump it to the shoe tops of.
Well, you know, Bob Kessling showed you the caboose, you know, and with the caboose goes the train engine and the whistle. I think he heard Todd Kelly whistling around the outside of Ernest Dye that time.
Here's 58 Kelly, 21.5 career sacks. Number 2 all-time at Tennessee behind the 32 of Reggie White, who played from 80 to 82. Carolina 3rd and 8. They've only been 30% today. They're coming up the middle. Tannehill cannot escape. We do have a flag.
And you figure it's probably somebody grabbing one of those defenders trying to hold them off the quarterback.
You know, Larry Marmee, the defensive coordinator here at Tennessee, figuring his guys match up pretty well in the secondary and puts pressure on Tannehill in these must-pass situations. He just doesn't have any time to throw. Those linebackers penetrate there. Ben Talley up the middle. He gets flushed out. Looks like Reggie Ingram brings him down.
Time to kick it. They're calling Marty Simpson today. He has been one of their most valuable players with his booming kicks. Last time, that not the case. But from this position on the field, he has a chance to kick Tennessee into poor field position. Sean Summers is back at his 10. Probably won't go back any further. Ball is pooched high in the air. Fair catch signaled and taken at the 11 by Summers. Marty Simpson did his job. We'll see if the defense of South Carolina can do its. A 38-yard kick. Volunteers by three, third quarter. Welcome back to Columbia, South Carolina. Williams-Brice Stadium, home of the Gamecocks. 17-14, Tennessee, 4:45, third quarter. And our view from the Family Channel blimp, high up above on a gorgeous Halloween afternoon. Bob Carpenter, Tim Foley, Bob Kessling. Our Jefferson Pilot sports crew, our producer Tom Hewitt, director Dave Burchett. And this one still very much anybody's game in the third quarter. Tennessee deep in its own territory. Heath Schuler. And the give was James Little Man Stewart.
Eric Anderson has replaced Frank Adams at the corner. I imagine they're just trying to give Adams a blow here. And now Ron Neely is replacing Eric Anderson. And so you can bet Phil Fulmer up on his perch here in the press box. The offensive coordinator for Tennessee sees a new cornerback in the game. It won't be long before he's tested.
Neely, a freshman out of Pottstown, PA, a true freshman who was All-American last year. Might have been a busted play. Schuler, not much of anything he could do. Cedric Bembry closed on him, as did Ernest Dixon from right outside backer.
And Ernest Dixon backed up Gerald Dixon last year, an outside linebacker, and he backed up in Eric Brown, an inside linebacker. And he's the guy that caused the fumble late in the Vandy game that sealed that victory for the Gamecocks.
Stopped the Vandy possible game-winning drive with 2.5 minutes to go. Gamecocks won their second in a row. Can they do it again today? Third down and 5. Play action. Schuler rolling right. Sideline pattern. Well done, and looked like Craig Faulkner over there. Faulkner has been their top receiver in terms of distance today.
And
he's caught two long ones, and now this key sideline pass.
You have to get somebody upfield right now to stop this rollout. That's what Alabama did so effectively against Tennessee. They didn't let Schuler extend that play. And Faulkner working on Rocky Clay. Rocky had a lot of room to protect him. Faulkner with the quick feet broke it out and made the catch.
Not to mention four catches for 68 yards. And there's a tackle for a loss. Knifing his way in, Tony Watkins. His eighth tackle of the day. He had 10 against Vanderbilt last week.
And it looks like he's coming on the blitz this time. Just really strong, upfield, aggressive, and I think they thought that maybe Fulmer might come back with another rollout that way, and they wanted somebody in Schuler's face. But great play by Watkins. He beat the block and made a big tackle.
Little Man Stewart is bigger than Tony Watkins. Didn't matter that time. Watkins leads the Gamecocks with 62 tackles now this year.
Out of the top six tacklers on the Gamecock defense, four of them are defensive backs.
That's usually not good.
That's not usually a good sign.
Timeout, Carolina. Arkansas leading at Auburn second quarter. We'll see the Razorbacks next week. Michigan has taken the lead on Purdue.
Well, the Boilers are making it interesting.
Foley not singing the fight song anymore. He's hummed a few bars, but he's waiting for the Fat Lady to start singing.
Uh-oh.
We've got 2:32 to go here. A dandy at halftime in the ACC. Maryland hanging tough with 22nd ranked North Carolina. They've been the upset kings lately. And Heath Shuler, who's over 200 total yards today, huddling with his crew, trying to figure out a 2nd and 17.
And what they don't want to do is cause something to, they don't want to give South Carolina any ammunition here. South Carolina's been opportunistic on defense, and so they're going to tell Shuler to be careful with the football. Don't take any chances with it, but they also can't sit on it, as Johnny talks to Mark Bradley, the tight end coach. If they can't protect a three-point lead.
Second down and 17. Three wide receivers in there for the Volunteers. Shuler alone in the backfield, and he is sacked. Ernest Dixon. His second sack of the year.
Now that could have been an automatic, Bob. They lined up with actually five wide receivers in the game. No backs in the backfield. Some coaches like to attack this with a blitz. Nobody touches Dixon. So Shuler either has a hot receiver there or he's going to roll away from it. That time he didn't do either one and went down.
Ernest Dixon, the junior out of Fort Mill, South Carolina, played at Fort Union Prep in Virginia for a year. Getting his chance this season. Third and 24. Shuler, quarterback draw. He's to the 30.
Whoa.
Clamped down hard at the 32-yard line. The ball came loose after the hit by Norman Green. Gamecocks claiming they have it, and they do. With the football, inside linebacker Eric Brown. And there's the man who made the hit.
Great call here by Tennessee. They're anticipating a blitz. Shuler gets nailed by Norman Green. The ball comes out. Great hit by Green. And the Gamecocks come up with a big turnover. Norman Green very frustrated with the fact that he had missed Shuler on the touchdown. And I'd say they're even now.
That's what you call separating someone from the football. Tannehill rolling right, straight ahead. And it's dropped by Matthew Campbell. Campbell backs up Boomer Foster at tight end. A junior out of North Augusta, South Carolina.
He was
looking for his seventh catch of the year.
I'm sorry, I'd say that Tannehill rolls out like Dan Marino or Joe Namath or Sonny Jurgensen. You wouldn't necessarily look at that move and say agile.
Still completing better than 50%. Second and 10 from the 32. A flag flies, right end jumped for Tennessee. That one was off to Terry Wilburn. Todd Kelly on the right side encroached in the neutral zone. Or in other words, he went offside.
Johnny Majors actually taking Todd Kelly out of the game. You know, he wants to talk to him a little bit and
offside.
Get him settled down. I'm sure that he had some other offsides. Kelly concentrates so much on getting off on the ball. Sometimes that extra intonation, that little inflection of the voice can draw you off. Todd knows he's supposed to look at the football. He's irritated with himself, and Johnny just wants to settle him down a second. Then he'll have him back in the game momentarily.
That makes it a 2nd and 5. Out of the eye, Wilburn feeling his way. First down, down to the 20-yard line. That's what you call reading your blocks.
You bet. And he was behind the moving wall there. Ernest Dye. He was just tucking in behind Ernest. This guy's 330 pounds from Greenwood, South Carolina. Look at number 65.
Wow.
Up, boom, 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 boom. And he's just rolling him down the field. He had Steve White. He just kind of drove him off the ball. But, Steve, you're not alone there.
Georgia Tech escapes Duke. 2017. Drake leading Clemson. How about that? That ACC is turning into a rough league week to week. There are no patsies in that league anymore. Wilburn the carrier. J.J. Surlis. And there's 96, Kevin Mays, who we talked about earlier.
Shane Bonham. Some big fellas in the middle. You know, not real long on talent, but extra long on effort and aggressiveness, and they do a great job of tying down the middle there for Tennessee.
Third down and 11 play coming up, and South Carolina not shy about using timeouts. With 15 minutes and 12 seconds left in the game, including only 12 here in the quarter, they will spend their second timeout. They used up their second timeout in the first half with 13:17 left to go before halftime. This time it comes even earlier. What about that, Tim, with the third quarter ending only 12 seconds from now?
Well, that's not something that you want to do necessarily, but you also don't want to, you want to make sure you're on the same page, and that's, so you got to give Tannehill credit for that. You saw him sitting there talking with Blake Williamson, and it's been tough for Blake Williamson. It's been tough for Sparky Woods. You know, he started out with Wright Mitchell, and he was the senior, and he wanted to be loyal to the senior, but Wright Mitchell just couldn't get the job done. And Blake Williamson then came in, and Blake's just a fantastic kid, Jack Armstrong type of guy. He just didn't have the talent that Tannehill had, and once he felt Tannehill was comfortable enough with the offense, Sparky put the ball in his hands.
Two tight ends on second and 11. Toby Cates was the motion man. Tannehill rolls that way. Down the field, and it was an incomplete pass. Matthew Campbell again having trouble finding that handle. There was some contact down there.
Well, I think there was some contact that knocked the ball loose. See if we can pick it out here. Getting some depth on the outside.
Had possession for a counter, too.
Was that Parker? I think it was Jason Parker that knocked it out, number 7. Tannehill was patient, waited for the tight end to come open, put the ball on the money, but it was a good play by the defender. Popped it loose.
Third and 11. 5 seconds to go in the third quarter. Up top, the big man. But the pass was short, and it never got close to Don Chaney. Steve Session easily defending on the play. Tannehill just didn't hang it up high enough for his 6'6 wide receiver.
And Chaney can certainly get up. He has done this in the last couple of games, come down with big touchdowns on leaping catches. And you're right, Bob, it just didn't get out there. Sessions has a chance to make the interception, but can't hang on.
And a game-tying field goal attempt when we return for the fourth quarter. Dogs and dogs next Saturday, but the Gamecocks trying to tie the Volunteers here with a 38-yard attempt by Marty Simpson. It looks perfect. He drilled it, and this game is tied at 17 on the first play of the fourth quarter. Tennessee will get the ball back when we come back to Columbia. Gamecocks hanging tough with the Vols. 4 seconds into the final quarter of play. South Carolina has tied it up with a field goal. Tennessee on the return. Ronald Davis. Getting an opening over the 30, out to the 35-yard line. Davis came in averaging 20 yards a return with a long of 34 against Georgia this year. And there's the field goal that tied the game for Marty Simpson.
South Carolina had an opportunity in the first half after a fumbled punt to convert that turnover into points. They were unsuccessful. This time, Simpson turns a fumble by Heath Shuler into a 3-point.
First down at the 35. South Carolina has hunched up with its opponents in the fourth quarter this year. They've only been outscored in the other period. But in the fourth quarter this year, South Carolina has outscored its opponents 33-31. That may not sound like much, but when you start out 0-5, that's a pretty strong fourth quarter performance.
Right, and you're only averaging 9.5 points a game for the first 5 games. We've been joined in the booth by our executive producer, Jimmy Rayburn, a Tennessee graduate, pacing anxiously.
Last time he did that, they lost at home to Arkansas. He should know better than to hang out with us.
Second and 10 at the 35. Double fake in the backfield. Shuler rolls and throws on the run. And out there in the left flat, Kendrick Jones, the split end with it. A sophomore out of Collierville High School. His 11th catch of the year.
You're going to see one of the outside receiver just pull up right there. They're going to run in behind with Faulkner. Watkins reacts to the short receiver. Try to keep him inside out, Tony, but they hang on to make the tackle.
Jones, one of a bunch of tailbacks Tennessee recruited. Some of them are wide receivers now. Some of them are DBs. And they all say they want to carry the ball someday.
And some of them are linebackers, too, right? George Kidd and Jesse Sanders and Victor Brown.
Player down. Is that Norman Green? No, it's not. I saw the six. It's Rocky Clay, number 36. Right corner. Only South Carolina player from the state of Tennessee. He's out of Bristol. He made that last hit over there, and he will leave slowly, but on his feet, fortunately. We're told it was just a cramp, so that's good news, as opposed to a hard hit.
So, Rocky Clay being escorted off the field, their best defensive back in terms of man-to-man coverage is Frank Adams. And
it's Adams with the cramp and
right.
Clay with the hit.
Well, so they've got the second team cornerbacks in there.
Against a good quarterback on third and three. He'll run the option. Nothing there. Lawrence Mitchell, who backed up Ernest Dixon, an outside linebacker, came in. And that's his third sack of the year.
No place to go on that one. Shuler, very competitive, likes the idea of keeping it.
Great
Tony Watkins was there, great penetration. Watkins was there, so he really didn't have the pitch to go to. He makes the right choice. But a lot of Gamecocks are staring him in the face.
Tom Huck kicking it to Terrell Harris, back at his 15. Wobbly kick. The signal, a fair catch, and taken at the 21. 12:53 to go. The Gamecocks have held the Volunteers again. Now they go to work offensively in a tie game. Just pictures from the family channel airship today here in Columbia, South Carolina. A 17-17 tie with 12:53 to go. Bob Carpenter, Tim Foley, Bob Kessling. It's first and 10 for the Gamecocks at their own 21. They've got the back split. Three wide receivers. Tannehill looking left. He's got Toby Cates. Simple little pattern that gets about seven. Tracy Smith from right corner, forcing him out for Tennessee. Let's get an update from the sidelines late in the game. It's getting to be crunch time, Bob Kessling.
And South Carolina lost one of their key offensive linemen, Kevin Rosenkrantz. You can see he's got a knee brace on. He is out. The guy taking his place is Corey Lucci, number 70. The interesting story about him, he originally signed with Tennessee, but there was a question about his test scores. He had to go to South Carolina State Junior College, and now he's playing with the Gamecocks in a crucial situation against the team he originally signed with.
And it gets a pretty tough defensive front. He's facing the likes of Jeff Tullis and James Wilson over there on that left side. There's big number 70, 6'9", 305 out of Greenville. Here's a defensive tackle at South Carolina State. So he's made the shift to offense and to starter now.
They go to the short yardage offense. Blake Williamson comes into the football game. And
Williamson, that, number 10.
That gives him the threat of an option.
Redshirt freshman. Deep man on the give and tumbling forward for the first down. Out over the 33-yard line, Brandon Bennett, the man they call on.
Don't get much movement here, but Bennett doesn't need much. Surless diving through, finding his way. Talley taking on a blocker, but then Bennett just rolls in over the top. and there's a Tennessee player down on the field. Great effort by Brandon Bennett, 113 yards.
Still managing to average about 7 yards a carry, and there's Reggie Ingram, who's had a shoulder problem lately. He's down on the field. They've already lost the guy next to him, George Kidd. Ingram, the team leader in tackles, coming in with 69. He had 14 hits, 11 solos against Alabama 2 weeks ago.
And he was the most experienced returning linebacker. He might have been the only returning linebacker, actually. They got all the other linebackers from the offense. They were all running backs. Except Ben Talley played a little bit as a true freshman last year. And when he wasn't in there against Arkansas and against Alabama, they've got some good athletes backing them up, but they're not as sure what to do.
Well, so one's a freshman. They got Nick Jester, a freshman. Armando Fisher, a sophomore.
And Nick is from Delray Beach, Florida. He's just 200 pounds.
First down. Here they come. Tannehill dumps it off. He was looking, at least in the area, was Mike Reddick. And I'll tell you, if he had been able to get the ball to Reddick, he might have scored.
Well, that was the same play they'd run earlier in the game that Reddick went 22 yards for touchdown with. There was nobody near him, and everybody else was locked up man-to-man.
You're right. There was one man in the secondary, and he was locked up with the receiver. Reddick might have gone 67 yards on that play. It will be second and 10. 11:52 to go in a tie football game. Danny Hill with a deep drop. Little touch pass. There's Reddick. He's out to the 42-yard line. He needed to get just beyond the 43 for a first down. Tracy Smith from right corner getting up number three with the stop.
Good stick by Tracy Smith as he comes up here to stop Reddick. He kind of slipped down as he began to break forward. Tannehill dumps it off in the flat, kind of lays it up there nicely. Reddick makes the catch and bang. Smith is there and gets some help from his friends.
Reggie Ingram is back in there for Tennessee at Mike or middle linebacker. Blake Williams in on third and one. Quarterback in the game time. Pitch. Bennett. First down. He's across the 45 out to the 47-yard line. And it was Reggie Ingram coming right back in that was riding him all the way over the first down yardage.
Watch Tennessee play here. You see 90 Ben Talley firing up field. Ingram moving down the line of scrimmage. A good block by Matthew Campbell on an outside linebacker created the seam. If Ingram hadn't filled that seam, Brandon Bennett might have gone a long way.
He's making a bid for player of the week in the league. If South Carolina could pull the upset here. He's got the deep hit. And he was stopped pretty solidly there. It looked like Steve White, 64, the redshirt freshman out of Memphis, who's third on the depth chart at right defensive end. We have not seen Horace Morris today, who normally backs up Todd Kelly. Don't know if there's a problem with him. We were not told of any problem with Morris before the game today. But they have to like the way the redshirt freshman is playing. Sidelines, ball high in the air and way beyond the reach of Toby Cates. That play has not worked yet for the Gamecocks today. Probably 0 for 4 or 5 with that sideline pattern.
Well, Parker was there to help, and Deron Jenkins is a true freshman that they've got in there at cornerback now. They're trying to give Steve Session a little rest before the final 2 minutes of the game as John Chavis signals in the defense for Tennessee.
Third down and 10.
What do you think? A move to the throat. What do you think that means?
Don't choke. Either that or shove it right down their throat. There's a screen pass. Reddick has it. There he goes. Inside the 40. First down. Volunteers were coming en masse, and the Gamecocks had the perfect answer. Reddick now 3 catches for 45 yards.
Tennessee upfield very aggressively. Tannehill does a nice job of looping that over Talley's head. And then Reddick just runs through some volunteers.
First down at the 39-yard line of Tennessee. Clock with a 9.5 minutes to go. Rob DeBoer angling toward the sideline.
It's incredible in terms of a team that was rated fourth in the country at one time, Tennessee, that they have this much inexperience. I mean, that's just an exceptional job of teaching when you can get this many players with no college experience, true freshmen, maybe first time away from home, on the field and actually working as a unit.
Second down and 7. Robinson, the motion man. DeBoer, big hole. Looks like another first down. Down to the 26-yard line.
Great job by the right side, Corey Lucci and Antoine Rivens. Kenny Farrell, they double team the nose. But Ingram can't make the play. Deron Jenkins comes in there to cut him down. And look at DeBoer. He runs like a catcher, doesn't he?
First and 10 at the 26. Boomer Foster shifting over to tight end. Single back set. It's DeBoer. They are really opening up some unbelievable holes. What are the Gamecocks doing to this front four of Tennessee?
Let's see this Tennessee linebacker core work on it. Kelly upfield, Ingram gets blocked by Antoine Rivens. Look at the receivers working downfield. Ernest Dye, 330 pounds, hurdling someone. Now, this is excitement. Great block by Rivens. Good block by the tight end. And look at Dye downfield, hustling. He comes from the other side.
Second down and 1. Little play action. Tannehill looking straight ahead. High risk pass. Pass interference on Matthew Campbell. He was the intended receiver, and draped all over him was J.J. McCleskey.
J.J. couldn't have covered much of him.
Campbell 6'5", 255. J.J. 5'8", 172.
Johnny Majors pointed out J.J. is one of the most valuable players that Tennessee has on the field. Tannehill's looking deep. Good coverage by Tennessee. J.J. makes the leap a little bit too soon, and the official picks it up. Pass interference.
Now, you wonder when you see that replay why Tannehill didn't throw the ball earlier. You're right, Tim. He was looking into the end zone and then found the man nearer him.
Jason Parker was in good shape
pass
there.
Interference.
And so there was no room.
Automatic first down.
First and goal from the 9. McCleskey says, come on, Volunteer fans. We need you now. The Gamecocks, with 7:39 to go, a chance to take command of the game.
They're going with two tight ends here, one wide. The big one, Kenny, on the outside.
Running out of the eye. Strong side left they're showing. DeBoer straight ahead. They'll stop his forward progress just outside the 5-yard line. Rob DeBoer, 9 rushes, 59 yards, combined with Bennett. Those guys are going to combine for about 200 yards today.
This is DeBoer's drive. He's taking it down there. They've got the running inside. And they've got Tracy Smith, all out there by himself, all alone out here.
Second and goal from the 5. Pitch, Bennett trying to turn the corner. He makes some yardage out of it. Just when it appeared he might be stopped for a loss by Todd Kelly, who was knifing his way through there. Bennett turned it up and gets down to the 3.
Good job by Kelly. Watch him move along the line of scrimmage. DeBoer trying to cut somebody down. Kelly leaps in behind it. McCleskey there as he struggles with DeBoer. Victor Brown, number 16, there to help out. 3rd and 3.
Speaking of leap, Bennett leaped away from the hands of Todd Kelly. 3rd and goal from the 3. Cates, the motion man. Tannehill looking for him. He's got it. He's
scores!
Important extra point. Tannehill wants to get the crowd going like he did at Vanderbilt last week. And now they lead by 7. The Gamecocks are for real. They lead the Volunteers by 7, 6:15 to go. The Gamecocks have never scored as many as 24 points in a game this year. Now they have. They lead by 7 as Tannehill found Toby Cates.
Run motion to the sideline. Good throw by Tannehill. Puts it on the money. Sessions is there. Cates makes a brave move. Fights his way back inside and scores before Smith can get there to help out. Sessions in good shape. DeBoer gets a chop block that opens it up for him. Now, great move by Cates. And lunges for the touchdown.
The freshman from Altoona, if you can do it, it ain't bragging. Line drive kick. Ronald Davis hurdles one blocker, and he will crack it out to the 30-yard line before he's wrapped up by number 35, James Flowers, on special teams. Tennessee Volunteers, plenty of time left. Check it, it's number 32 for Carolina, Rick Robinson. They've got 6:08 to go. All their timeouts. Carolina ate up better than 6.5 minutes on its drive. There's the timeout situation.
And a lot of that was DeBoer.
Pete Shuler rolling, escaping. They'll get about 8 yards out to the 38. Tim, a very interesting potential decision faces Johnny Majors. Should he get in the end zone and score, does he have to go for the W?
I don't know. I'm going to refer that to Jimmy Rayburn.
let's see what happens. But it probably depends on how soon. If it takes him a long time to score, he may have to go for 2. A tie doesn't do him any good in the rings.
No, it doesn't.
But if he scores quickly, he might be able to kick the extra point and tie the game. But they've got a long way to go.
Yes, they do. And South Carolina's got to get somebody upfield on defense. Slide turnip seed in Eric Sullivan just a little bit wider to make sure they don't get pinned on that rollout. They need to shut Keith Shuler's path off as he rolls out. Eric Sullivan coming back into the football game now.
Majors team, once with national championship, Sugar Bowl hopes. Now they're fighting for their lives against a team that 15 days ago was 0-5.
But
first down for the Volunteers.
This isn't the same team as the team that we saw a couple weeks ago when we saw them go 0-5. Offensively, they ran the ball fairly effectively, but they had nothing going when it came to throwing a ball. And here they mix in a little bit of the pass, and it's just enough to complement the good running game that they have so they can move the ball down the field.
First and 10 at the 40. Shuler with a fake. Time to throw. Far sideline, he's got a man inside the 20-yard line. That is James Stewart, and he almost put it into the end zone.
Great throw by Shuler. We talked about there. See, there's too much unmolested time back there for a man with the arm like Keith Shuler. Good job of faking. Nobody coming from the outside. Got all day. And Stewart worked his way clear down the sidelines, and Shuler put it right on him.
41 yards, first and 10 at the 19. Option, Shuler keeping. Dragged down from behind by Tony Watkins.
Ball security, Heath. They're going to whack you around down here. He knows that. Last time he carried it, they separated him from the ball. But what a competitor. You can bet that he's never going to think they're ever beaten. And if it comes down to going for two or one, what do you think Shuler's going to suggest?
A deuce. You bet. Second down and three. Volunteers jumping all over the place. That could turn a second and three into a second and eight. And their line of scrimmage on both sides of the ball today has really made some mental mistakes.
Dead ball. False start on the offense.
Johnny's thinking, well, we sure don't want to do this the easy way, right? Second and three, that's too easy.
Well, he always says about his offensive line, Philip Fulmer keeps them good and hungry. They were a little too hungry that time.
Write this down. We're going to work on snap count practice on Monday afternoon. They can take this note down.
Second down and eight. A couple of yards, and they almost had another man jumping off too soon. Ronald Davis was split out wide to the right, and he was off right with the snap and almost too quickly.
This is the dimension that the Tennessee offense that has, and how many offenses have. Good reaction. Eric Brown, number 48, gets back in it. Hank Campbell gets back in it. The linemen got to be thinking about it. You got to be thinking quarterback draw in these situations.
Third down and five at the 14. 3:55 to go. Had to throw it quickly. And near the first down marker, Norman Green had a shot at James Stewart, but he couldn't stop him. Stewart at 6'1", 195. And he already had a full head of steam.
This is the same play that South Carolina ran to score. A little pick. Faulkner tries to pick off his man. Stewart makes the catch. Green is there, but can't hang on. Good hustle by Brown and his compatriots to get there to knock him out. And I guess he didn't get it.
He is very short. And when I mean short, it's the length of a football. It comes down to a fourth and inches at the 9-yard line of South Carolina.
3:46 left to go.
Shuler. He might have dropped the football. Who came up with it? And if it was Tennessee, did they move the ball forward?
It looked like it came out as the ball was snapped.
Preserving for now a 7-point lead.
There's Sparky Woods there, and he's got to be proud of these guys.
I don't think they ever made the exchange.
Nope, the ball is gone right now. Keith never had it, and I'm not sure where it's going to go after that, but you know, Sparky Woods had a heart-to-heart talk with his team after they voted that he should be fired as the coach. He said, guess what? You guys don't get a vote. I'm going to be here tomorrow. If you want to play, you'll be here tomorrow, too. And that was the beginning of the turnaround.
Tannehill on a busted play. Smothering him was Shane Bonham.
One thing you can be sure of, that this Tennessee offense, with the explosive power that it has, doesn't need long to score. Sparky would love for his Gamecocks to get a first down here so he could start eating into some of those Tennessee timeouts. Now, that doesn't help by losing 2 yards on first down.
Tennessee, all three of its timeouts to go. Tannehill out of the eye. Crowd deathly quiet. And again for Brandon Bennett. Just a couple of yards out over the 10. Timeout called by Tennessee with 2:40 to go. We will take one as well. South Carolina with the ball trying to hang on to a 7-point upset.
And by Nationwide Insurance. Check the yellow pages for the Nationwide agent nearest you.
And on third and eight, South Carolina's Brandon Bennett unable to get anywhere near the first down. Johnny Majors will get the ball back again.
Sparky Woods chooses not to put the ball at risk, just hand the ball to a running back. He's got confidence in his defense. They can keep the Tennessee Volunteers out of the end zone. Now they need what they need is a big punt. And what Tennessee needs is what worked against them a few weeks ago when we saw the Arkansas game. They need a big return.
Tennessee has called its second timeout with 2:34 to go. They'll get the football back on the next play. They'll have a timeout left to work with on their two-minute offense.
You know, Johnny Majors prides himself on his team's special teams play. And keep your eye on J.J. McCleskey. I mean, he's been challenging the punter all day long, and they may try to block this. Actually, that probably wouldn't do them any good. They'd rather return it.
Two minutes and 34 seconds to go, and now the pressure shifts to the snapper, Derek Gregory, a freshman, and the sophomore punter, Marty Simpson. Sean Summers standing at his own 47-yard line. They're setting up for the return. Oh, it's a beautiful kick. Back to the 36 of Tennessee. Summers to the near side. Taken down at the 41. What a kick by Marty Simpson, and what a time for it. Ernest Dixon on the stop. And the Gamecocks keep making one big play after another. Tennessee, though, has it back. 2:21 to go. A 55-yard kick.
Kicker never likes to be standing in the paint, but he blasts this one out of there. Just perfect. Couldn't have done any better. He feels great about it. Cover, Marty, cover.
Now just don't make me make the tackle.
Right.
Okay, Volunteers. First down. At the 42. This one is complete. Corey Fleming escaping the first tackler. Running down to the two-minute mark.
Gamecocks forced Fleming back into the field. Couldn't get to the sideline. And remember that the Gamecocks are playing without their best coverage defensive back, Frank Adams.
Shuler has the first down and not getting out of bounds at the 40-yard line. And that is Kendrick Jones. They'll move the chains and the clock will be stopped. 1:47 to go.
1:47 on the clock. If you're the coach that's ahead, you never saw a shorter 40 yards in your life. You know, on the other side of the ball, it looks pretty lengthy.
Shuler flushed out, dumps it off. Mose Phillips, he escapes a couple of tacklers. Still on his feet, inside the 20, the 10, and he is in the end zone. With a minute 28 to go.
Now they were shooting a movie at halftime. And, you know, the guy was supposed to go all the way for a touchdown, and they had hired people to miss tackles. But I've not seen as many missed tackles in one run as you're going to see right here. Count them. One, two, three. Here comes four, five, six. Great job of running. Seven. Great job of running by Phillips, but come on, guys. Eight, and he fights. Hey, if he got
that close on that run, give it to it. He deserves it. Hey, if you knock the pylon over, you're in. Eight tackles missed. And a 24-23 game with 1:28 to go. Tennessee looks like it's going for two. In the SEC East, a tie wouldn't do them any good. They've got to get the win and go 4-2. Because Tennessee could be a half game behind Georgia. If Florida beats Georgia today, Georgia would be 5-2. Tennessee and Florida would both be 4-2. But if Georgia wins and they're leading 7-3 first quarter right now, Tennessee would need a win to stay within a game and a half of the Bulldogs. First things first, Tennessee has to get into the end zone. Center Brian Spivey, quarterback Keith Shuler. They thought they might have lost the game when those two could not combine on the fourth and one exchange.
The Tennessee has moved the ball out of the middle of the field. Wide side right. Stewart and two wide receivers lined up to the right.
Shuler looking right, throwing, complete, but not into the end zone. Norman Green in on the stop. The stadium is shaking as South Carolina preserves the one-point lead, and Tennessee has a probable onside kick coming up.
Lawrence, it's a fights up the field. Watkins in Shuler's face, makes him pull up, get rid of it early, which is great hustle by the Quinn Watkins charging. He gets up inside, the ball is now in the air, going a little bit behind. Campbell comes from his inside linebacker position to make the play.
Campbell, a sophomore out of James Island, South Carolina.
Okay, but now comes the most exciting play in football and the most unpredictable with that squirrely shaped football and a lot of guys that are nervous as cats trying to catch it.
The onside kick. Just ask Tennessee about that. They found out about it when Arkansas was in town 3 weeks ago. A minute 28 to go. Volunteers down by a point, trying to get that football back.
What a fantastic run by Mose Phillips.
There's the kickoff man, Joey Chapman, a junior.
Now, I used to be on this onside kickoff, and you cannot win on this thing. If you catch it, you're supposed to catch it. You can only screw it up.
And if you catch it, you might get killed.
Well, that's part of life. So you got one of those helmets on, somebody's going to hit you eventually.
Seven volunteers shipped over to that side, and it takes a very easy bounce for South Carolina. Tennessee never got the big bounce it was looking for, and Ben Hogan, a senior linebacker, covered it up. Stacy Robinson helping out as well. So South Carolina has it. Tennessee cannot stop the clock. A minute 26 to go.
Back in Knoxville, Tennessee would have had the advantage of the turf, and that makes it a little bit more unpredictable. Sparky Woods is almost starting to feel like this is over.
3 weeks ago, they wanted to hang him. Now 70,000 want to take him out to dinner.
They're going to extend his contract after this game.
Tannehill kneels on the ball.
It's so crazy, you know?
Look at him. The flamboyant freshman out of Altoona, PA. Only problem is he's looking right over some Tennessee volunteers who are saying to themselves, "You'll come up to our place next year, young fella."
You bet.
And they don't forget this sort of thing. That's the only problem some people have with Tannehill's act.
Right.
Even some of his teammates couldn't get used to him at first.
You can bet his quotes will appear on the visiting team's locker room, right? You know what I'm saying? When they send the articles home. But who cares? He's 3-for-3. Sparky Woods and his staff have done a great job grabbing control of a situation that was plummeting into disillusionment, and he's brought them back. It's not all Steve Tannehill. Great running by DeBoer and Bennett. Super blocking up front. And a great defensive effort made this all possible.
And meanwhile, Tennessee is starting to see any hope of playing on New Year's Day start to fall. They were thinking about a Sugar Bowl and a national championship, but now they will be 5-3 with three consecutive losses. It's a Halloween celebration in Columbia. South Carolina upsets Tennessee. Back with our post-game show after a word from your local station. It's going crazy here in Columbia time. Carolina beats Tennessee down to the stadium floor. Bob Kesslin.
Coach Woods, congratulations. What a terrific football game and a terrific win for your program.
Well, thank you. I've got to commend Tennessee on what a great game they played coming in here in a tough area. Great football. Congratulations to South Carolina. So proud of our football team, boy. The last minute or so, they showed their players showed how determined they were to win by breaking, I don't know how many tackles, and then putting it in. And then we responded, showed how determined we were to win by keeping him out of the end zone. Great college football game. I'm happy for South Carolina.
I mean, what a huge win for this program.
That's great for our players. I tell you, they just hung together. They've been through so much adversity. And the seniors, they just wasn't going to give it up, were they? It's a great opportunity to be a part of it. I'm happy for these people of South Carolina. They've been so tough and give so long. It's a great start for something that can be great at South Carolina.
Go celebrate with your team, Coach.
Absolutely. Thank you very much.
Sparky Woods, what a big win for his Gamecocks.
Time to announce our JP Sports Players of the Game for Tennessee quarterback Heath Shuler. Almost 300 yards passing, and Brandon Bennett for Carolina over 100 yards rushing with a touchdown. As part of our Players of the Game Award Scholarship Program, JP Sports donates $2,000 to the SEC to be distributed among its member institutions. Along with Tim Foley and Bob Kesling, Bob Carpenter, that's it from Columbia, where the upset goes the way of the Gamecocks, 24-23. The executive producer of JP Sports is Jimmy Rayburn. Coordinating producer, Wendy Boyd. Today's game produced by Tom Hewitt, directed by Dave Burchett. Technical manager, Pal Kidd. Join us next week from Starkville, Mississippi. The Razorbacks of Arkansas take on the Bulldogs of Mississippi State. JP Sports personnel outfitted by Champion Products. And you've been watching Jefferson Pilot Sports' exclusive coverage of exciting Southeastern Conference football.
Bob, it was our test of being tested with those top teams in the SEC again. We knew that the line of scrimmage would be a real gauge to see how we would match up, and we matched up very well. So I think this gives us a chance to carry our program a step up in our level of play, and gives us a chance to compete in what we believe is the greatest conference in the country.
Stay with us. A lot of highlights coming from a packed Williams-Brice Stadium right after this.
Gamecock football with Sparky Woods is being brought to you by
your Carolina Lincoln Mercury dealers. Take a good look at Lincoln Mercury.
By Carolina Pride, makers of great-tasting hot dogs, luncheon meats, bacon, and sausage. And by Nations Bank, the power to make a difference.
All right, welcome back in the show, everybody. Coach, let's go ahead and take a look at those highlights. And, of course, as always, I'd like to thank the Womack Nursery Company for providing the highlights. It was a tremendous crowd, over 71,000, Coach.
Great crowd, beautiful day, South Carolina weather. Getting ready to play South Carolina versus University of Tennessee.
This is the SEC game of the week. And we'll start out here. A couple of possessions. This was really a defensive game until this possession.
Terry Wilburn breaks the ball out. This is a great matchup by our left tackle, Ernest Dye, and their defensive end, Todd Kelly. It was two first-round draft choices we went after all day. We're real proud of our top draft choice, Ernest Dye. This is Wilburn again, breaking up inside behind the lead block of Leroy Jeter. He's doing a good job running hard with that football. Making some holes on the line of scrimmage. This is going to be a gauge to see how we can match up with this football team.
13 yards for Wilburn. Come back in first and 10.
This play that Terry makes, he don't block many people at all. He makes a great run, makes people miss him, shows his speed. I know Coach Dale Evans from Dorman High School will be real proud of the way Kerry's playing.
Corbin gets 15 and will move to first and 10. DB Brandon Bennett.
Bring in Brandon Bennett. He's going to take that ball and bounce it outside. Good block by Stacy Robinson and split in. Watch Brandon move those feet. Make people miss him. He has a way to shift him, miss it. Charles' people have a hard time tackling him. Great run downfield. Good lead block by Vincent Dinkins. They hustle him downfield to get him in his way.
You talked about the matchup of Dye and Kelly. Kelly had two tackles on the day. Dye really did own him. An example of him again there. Bennett on his way to 29 yards. He had 124 on the day, and here's a reverse angle look.
Attempt to take that football and move them feet and keep packing down the field and causing people to miss.
Third and eight.
And Matt got some protection here. Did a good job. Steve picks up Mike Reddick. Mike splits the seam for a touchdown. Some great protection there and good execution by Mike and a good execution by Steve. That's a great call because Wilkins, he sit in there and he was watching the linebackers come. Did a good job picking up the inside linebacker blitz. And that little freshman from Miami puts the ball in the end zone.
First career touchdown for the freshman, Mike Reddick. 90 yards on seven plays, 7-0 South Carolina. Let's go to the second quarter.
Punt out our own end zone. Marty does a good job getting the ball punted here. They give us a break. They drop the ball. Alert Frank Adams, hustling down the field, recovers it. We've got an opportunity really to get some momentum. Shows deep. Tennessee's defense keeps us from getting any points. This is one of the disappointing things about the half. We've had opportunity to score, and we didn't get points out of that.
Third and eight.
They come back. We have busted coverage on third down conversion. Tua is a great player. He picks it up. This is a great tackle by Frank Adams, saving a touchdown as he's getting him down the field. This was a big play in the first half where they turned the momentum back around. We'll get some pressure on the quarterback here. We come inside and bring the strong safety in the corner, and we got man coverage and Rocky Clay, a senior from Bristol, Tennessee. He got his hands on the ball right there, had a chance for the interception, but nevertheless had good coverage on his receiver.
Third and eight.
Makes good coverage, makes the quarterback keep the ball, and then Hank Campbell shows up from his inside linebacker spot, makes a good hit, knocks the guy out, knocks Tua out of bounds.
They'll kick the field goal to make it 7-3, 9:22 to go. Now Tennessee ball a little bit later, first and five.
Well, you see what good backs they have, too. Watch their tailbacks run. Breaking tackles and getting the ball down the field and getting it down there close to the touchdown.
26 yards, sets up first and goal. Watch this great tackle coming up from Tony Watkins.
This is a great tackle. Tony's alert on the outside. He's going to come on the sweep. Open field tackle, a lot of room against a good back. Good open field tackle while Blackshirt's giving the football to Hank Campbell and Chris Rump.
Now, they'll put it in the end zone here on second and goal to take the lead in the first half.
Another good back. Well executed on the option. Phillips takes the ball, ducks inside this time for the touchdown, and they've got those guys out some good backs as well.
10-7 Volunteers, 5:21 to go. Now here's the big drive, first and 10.
We're not in a three-step game. Here's Seam Penny. Seam does a good job aggressively getting the football up the field for the first down.
Second and eight.
Brandon Bennett again. Brandon's going to run off the a drive block of Kevin Rosenkrantz, a right tackle. Unfortunate for us, Kevin was injured yesterday. We lost him with knee surgery this morning, but he played a great game, senior tackle. We're losing for his career, but we miss Kevin. Great game here. It's a great play by Steve Tannehill to Toby Cates. They connected on the line of a three-step game. Tennessee rolled the corner up. Steve pumped the ball, and Toby broke inside. Steve hit him for a big first down. Another one by Steve. Watch Steve come back, reverse it inside, hit the tight end down the middle this time, Boomer Foster. Two critical plays, two outstanding plays by our quarterback. He just gets better and better every day he comes forward.
Reverse angle look at that. Foster gets down to the one. That was a third and six play and a gain of 23. Sets up first and goal and now the attack offense.
Going to be Brandon Bennett. Watch him launch himself into the end zone. He really thrusts himself high and shows his ability get up and put the ball in the end zone. Good line surge by our offensive line off the left side. Let him take off, put it in the end zone.
Brandon in the end zone again, and where he's been most of his career. 14-10 now, makes it the halftime score. Stay with us. We'll be back right after these messages. All right, everybody, welcome back in, Coach. Let's go ahead and jump into these highlights. Of course, it was Halloween at Williams-Brice Stadium.
Got some shady characters here for the ball game.
Looks like some of J.D. Copeland's family made it to the game. Almost didn't recognize Paul Feinbaum there with his hat on. All right, here we go. University of Tennessee ball, second and two.
Come off Delvin Herring, freshman out of Jacksonville, Florida, when they're on the make the sack on the first play of the handoff to the tailback.
We're back on third and four here.
They're going to show their ability to move the football as Heath Shuler comes back. And no backs in the backfield. And gets the guy down the middle again. Hits the inside our linebacker. And was a good throw and catch. And great play to Tennessee.
Shuler was really impressive, not only throwing it, but running it. Here is first and 10.
One of our challenges, contain the quarterback. And here is an example where we let him break contain. He puts the ball in the end zone. Fine football player. When they couldn't contain him all day long, now here's one of those examples where he did break the team, scored first touchdown.
It came back to make it 17-14.
This is a great play by our play team. That's Tony Watkins coming in and splitting the two blockers on the inside and sweep, hitting their tailback for a loss.
Watkins had a great game. Here's second and 17.
Captain Ernest Dixon showing up on the sack. Coming around and making a play. There's an example of containing the quarterback. Great job of Ernest getting inside on the rush and happy Gamecocks. Celebrating there after a big sack.
How about this play? Third and 24, and Norman will grill Shuler.
This is a vicious hit. That's Norman coming in here. Really good back. There comes the ball. Great
Eric
contact
Brown.
Football. And it's all much to tell you, John. Norman brought that from Sumter High School. It was Tom Lewis, the way old Sumter Gamecocks play defense. Watch him come in and make this great hit.
Hello. Separation there. You see the ball. Eric Brown dives on it. Gamecocks take over. We'll end the third quarter there, 17-14. Fourth quarter now, and Marty Simpson has a 38-yarder.
It's a great kick here, 38 yards, with plenty of distance, split the uprights. Very critical play, tie the football game back. Good pressure kick by Marty.
14:56 to go, first and 10, Tennessee.
It's Troy Duke winning the war on the line of scrimmage, driving their guard back into the tailback. I think Chris Rump shows up there with a big hit, but it's a great job of Troy controlling the line of scrimmage.
Third and three.
Option, Tony Watkins takes away the pitch. Lawrence Mitchell's there, tackle quarterback for the conversion down to go our way this time.
South Carolina takes over, and what an impressive drive this was.
Great job of Steve Canhill. Seeing the rush, kind of dumping the ball off to Mike Reddick, giving the ball upfield. That could have been a bad play, and Steve turned it into a really good one.
Reddick gets nine, now third and 10.
This is maybe the best play for Steve today. Does a great job under heavy pressure, getting off the screen pass. Vincent Dinkins, Corey Lucci downfield for Mike Reddick to get the first down. And Corey Lucci, John signed with the University of Tennessee out of high school and then transferred. And glad to be playing now. He'll have to accept the starting role since Kevin's hurt. Watch it, Rob DeBoer attack him on this belly play where he rips up inside off a good lead block by our center, Kenny Farrell. Got another shot of this. Watch him roar up in there, those pads down, and turn those legs. It's a great run by Rob.
Well, Nebraska nightmare comes right back here on first and 10. DeBoer's going to pick up nine more.
Great block by right guard Antoine Rivens. He rubs off the nose and gets on the linebacker. And again, DeBoer running with abandon, gets the ball advanced up the field.
Third and goal from the three.
Great play here. We run the flood pass. Throws the ball out to Toby Case. It's a tremendous athletic move, but Toby put the ball in the end zone.
Take another look at this now. You pointed this out earlier as we looked at this. Watch the way Case slams on the brakes and makes a cut.
It's a great athletic move. It shows Toby's ability to be a great football player, and you see why we move him to receiver to make plays like this.
Sophomore has his second touchdown of the season. 24-17 Gamecocks, 6:15 to go.
Celebration there with the ball, guys. Everybody's happy.
They'll come right back. Credit to Tennessee, and they're 15th ranked. And this guy, quarterback Shuler, first and 10.
You know, you gotta watch. He's gonna roll out. He's gonna hit you. He never gives up. Puts him right back in the contest by hitting the tail back down the boundary where he got behind our linebacker and made the great throw and catch.
Fourth and one.
This is a great line surge by our defensive line. I tell you, when you run that quarterback sneak on that center, he's got to snap the ball and get line surge as well. Puts a lot of pressure on him. He did a good job being in there in a goal line defense and surging the line back. Ended up not making, giving us the ball back.
2:21 to go, and you got a punt.
Another pressure punt. Marty gets off a boomer, and then we get down the field, and it's a great coverage tackle by Ernest Dixon. The guy on the ground along with Blue Pender from Barnwell.
Well, that sets up the climax of an unbelievable college football game. Tennessee's last drive here. First and 10 from the 39.
Boy, this is a tremendous play by Phillips. The tailback, he catches the ball out of the backfield. I think he breaks tackles everybody on our team. He's determined to get the ball in the end zone. It's just a great run all the way around by their tailback, Phillips.
He goes out there at the one, but they'll score it a touchdown. I guess feeling like you break that many tackles, you deserve to get in. And so now that sets up a two-point conversion play.
That was a great run by Phillips. This is going to be a great tackle by Hank Campbell. This is a great tackle for us. They're going for the win. They understand, respect. They come off and get pressure on the outside. Hank does a good job of making a tremendous open field tackle against a good back and keeps them out of the end zone for a two-point play. Coaches did a great job preparing our team. I remember them talking on the phone to the defensive staff, saying they're either going to run the flood pass to the right or they're going to run the option in the short side of the field. So we called the play for them. Sorry we missed Stacy Robinson making a great hands play on their onside kick, securing the victory for us. And then we went into our victory offense where we knew the time was in our favor to just put away a great victory for South Carolina.
24-23, the final score. South Carolina upsets Tennessee. We want to thank the Womack Nursery Company for the highlights and for this Womack play of the day. 24-23, two-point conversion. Watch Hank Campbell.
It's a great play. You know, football is a game of feet and inches, and right here was an example of one play determining the ball game. They were in position to score to win the game. We were in position to keep them from scoring to win the game. Coaches put us in a good defense, but the players made the play. And Campbell made the play right here.
And now from Duquesne Gas Grills, where the difference is quality, the grill of the day. First win of the year for Norman Green, and boy, does he introduce himself to Shuler right here.
Real contact football play with a very vicious lick. Again, caught people flying around everywhere and alert Eric Brown to cover the fumble.
Another look at it from the end zone. Watch him separate the man from the ball. All right, so certainly congratulations are in order for your Gamecocks and for Hank Campbell and Norman Green. Also for Rob DeBoer. Rob DeBoer from Omaha, Nebraska, has been a staple in the backfield for the Gamecocks. Not only for his running, but also for his blocking, as you'll see why Rob DeBoer is this week's Portrait Player of the Week.
Number 31 has become a familiar sight in the Gamecock backfield, and a favorite one for South Carolina fans and coaches, but not for the opposition. Last week against Vanderbilt, DeBoer showed why opposing coaches and players hate to see the Omaha Twister in the backfield. Against the Commodores, Rob had a truly remarkable performance as he totaled 10 broken tackles on his way to 89 yards on just 8 carries. Couple that with a stunning 11 knockdown blocks and you can see why. A 5'10", 205-pound junior, Rob DeBoer, has been chosen as this week's Portrait Player of the Week.
Gamecock football with Sparky Woods has been brought to you by Nations Bank, by Carolina Pride, by your Carolina Lincoln Mercury dealers, and also by Duquesne Gas Grills, where the difference is quality, and by Columbia Farms, serving the Carolinas with quality products, fresh chicken, and other fine foods. The Trainer's Report, with head athletic trainer Dr. Rod Walters, is brought to you by Riddell. Quality since 1929.
As you can see from the highlights from yesterday's game, it was a very physical encounter on both sides of the ball. We had several guys bumped and bruised, but doesn't look like anything major other than Kevin Rosenkrantz, who did sustain a medial collateral knee sprain of his right knee. He underwent surgery to repair the ligament this morning. Dr. Peels performed that, and we anticipate a good outcome from his surgery. So for the Riddell Report, this is Dr. Rod Walters. John?
Okay, thank you, Doctor. Coach, boy, what a physical game it was.
Very physical, I tell you. It had a lot of bumps and bruises, as Dr. Walter mentioned, but I think the key thing is Kevin Rosenkrantz. He's a senior in surgery this morning, so we feel that he will be done for the year, and it's a difficult thing. It's one thing about football is that those injuries are something you can just never accept, but and nevertheless, Kevin's had a great career to come around and be the starting tackle, something he dreamed of doing at South Carolina and been a part of this turnaround. That also means we've got to pull on Corey Lucci to come on and be our starting right tackle, and that'll ask our depth of those guys like Chuck Driggers and Luther Dixon and some of those guys to step forward, Kevin Wade and Antoine Jackson's to come on and give us some depth in that offensive line, because we still have a real rugged schedule ahead of us.
And when you speak about the offensive line, I thought it was one of the keys to the game. Again, was the play of the line of scrimmage, and you said last week this would be a gauge for your team as how you would do in the line of scrimmage against a team like Tennessee.
I thought it would be a good gauge. I thought by just paying attention to when the ball was snapped and how much more physical Tennessee might be than we were on the line of scrimmage would be a good indicator of where we were in this conference and how far we have to go. I was very proud of how we competed and how we stood up. In fact, I feel very good about the fact that we may have held our own and even done better at times on the line of scrimmage.
All right, Forest Lake Travel brings us our preview of the opponent, Louisiana Tech. Not many people know it, but this is really a very, very good football team and an old football team.
Yeah, it's a mistake to assume that Louisiana Tech doesn't have a really fine football team. This is a team who tied us last year that have 18 returning starters back. This is a team that Coach Stallings at Alabama said was the best team they had played when we were there. Great. They got offensive linemen just like Ernest Dye. Ernest One will be one of the first tackles picked, I believe. And they've got a fierce defense. So this is a fine football team coming in. We've got to move on the momentum we have to try to make sure we're prepared.
All right, we've got some quick housekeeping items. You got something there from the alumni office.
I do. I have a license plate here. Flynn Bowie from our alumni office asked me to mention this to you. This is a sharp Gamecock license plate. And the fact, the good thing about it is we can represent South Carolina and bring attention to it. And most important, about half the money that is spent on this license plate will go to the General Scholarship Fund.
Okay.
Good cause.
Contact the Highway Department to find out about that or the alumni office. Don't forget, next week it's homecoming, so that means Friday night, Cockfest, 7 o'clock, Williams-Brice Stadium. Be there, catch Carrot Top. Admission is $3, $8 for family. We'll see you right here next week. So long, everybody.
The television crew's air transportation provided by Midlands Aviation. Ground transportation by Herndon Chevrolet Geo. Player portrait framing, compliments of Havens Gallery.